session. And we're live. So I am Drew Baye. This is Steve Maxwell. And, well, most of you probably don't need any introduction, but I'm going to let Steve tell you a little bit about his background, where he's coming from, so that those of you who don't already know who he is, you know, get an idea.
I started training in 1964. It's a long time ago. So I don't know how many years is that. It's well over half a century of training. Tried almost everything. But started in my father's basement in Carlisle, Pennsylvania. And I wasn't into bodybuilding per se. I was always looking for ways to become a better wrestler. I sucked at almost every sport, but wrestling I was pretty good at. And so everything was geared towards making me a better wrestler. And I eventually wrestled Division I NCAA. What do you do with wrestling after you graduate from university? There was no MMA in those days. So eventually I discovered Brazilian Jiu Jitsu. About 89, I started with the Gracies and got really involved with Gracie Jiu Jitsu and opened up the first academy in the Eastern United States. And I'm now black belt, sixth degree. One of the original, in fact, I was the first guy to get a black belt directly from the Gracie family here in the United States. There was another guy, Craig Kuka. So everything was always geared to making me a better athlete, as opposed to being more concerned with how much weight I could lift and hypertrophy and so forth. And I started training at the very first Nautilus gym in Pennsylvania in 1972, Huff and Puff Gym. By Greg Ellis and John Carton. Very first one. I had read some things that Arthur had written in Perry Rader, what was it, Iron Man. The old Perry Rader. And up to that point, I've been doing York barbell courses. My dad bought me like the Big 12 special. Maybe you remember those advertisements.
I am familiar with some of Bob Hoffman's stuff, and I've read some of his books and seen them in there, but I wasn't around for a lot of the original ones.
So my dad would take me to the York gym, and John Grimmick was there. Bob Hoffman was there. Bob Benarski actually showed me how to do Olympic lifting back in the day. So, yeah, it was like a real mecca. And I started – 1970 at Westchester State College. It was a physical education school. And I was getting my degree in health and PE. And that's when I discovered the high intensity training principles and immediately saw like, wow, this is a really good way to train. And my first Nautilus workout on the equipment, wow, it was quite an experience. I was absolutely convinced that this is like the ultimate in strength.
And where was that down
in? That was in Drexel Line Shopping Center in just outside of Philadelphia.
Okay.
I drove from Westchester, took the workout, made the mistake of telling them that I was a competitive wrestler. They absolutely crushed me with the workout. No mercy shown. But they did say, wow, I'm surprised you got through it. I did get through it. Most people wouldn't get through if they really pushed you, you know, the way they used to. The whole idea was to make me quit, just to prove to me that I wasn't in as good a shape as I thought. And I remember I had to sit there almost like in a state of shock until for almost 2 hours. So in fact, they were closing the gym and they had to kick me out so I could drive home.
I've seen
that's it. Just how messed up I was.
One of the interesting things about this, and it's just, I got to roll my eyes all the time. Everybody that's ever touched a barbell believes that they train hard.
I certainly believed I was training hard.
Yeah.
And I was doing 20 rep squat routines, which are pretty brutal.
It's harder done than most people will ever do. But so many guys, oh yeah, I train hard. I train intensely. If you haven't done this stuff, if you haven't been put through a workout by somebody who actually knows how to do this stuff, I know you all think you train hard. And a lot of you guys are thinking, well, I'm an exception. I really do train hard. You have no idea if you have not been put through one of these workouts by somebody who actually knows what they're doing. And you probably all know what you're doing too, or think you know what you're doing too. Trust me. I've heard this, and you've probably heard the same with your clients. I have had people that have come to Orlando, who even people who think they've been doing high intensity training for a long time. And they're like, yeah, okay, let me have it. You know, I train hard. I can handle this. And every single time, actually not every time, but almost every time, there's a couple exceptions. They are shocked at how much harder it is. The only exceptions have been people who were clients of other good HIT and super slow studios because they already had it coming in.
But in the early days, everyone was very skeptical. Part of it was because Joe Weider and Arthur Jones got into quite a pissing match. You know, there was a lot of bad feelings. And so you would have the doubters, and the doubters would come in talking a lot of smack. And so there was four trainers that used to work at Greg Ellis's gym. He called it Nautilus Medical Sports Inc., I think. He named it like after going. Anyway, we would take bets how quickly we could drop these athletes coming in that thought they really knew something. Usually within the fourth or fifth exercise, they were finished. They were done, man. They were just in a heap.
Yeah.
And so it was hard to get a lot of these guys to even train hard. The guys that thought they were training hard, it wasn't even close.
Yeah, well, and again, you know what I'm talking about. They do everything that they can during the exercise to make it as easy as possible to move the weight and avoid actually using it to keep tension in muscles.
Now, is it really necessary to push yourself that hard? Probably not. But as a young grappler and, of course, you know, later as a martial artist, this type of intensity is a real boon, because when you are involved with a really high intensity sport, wrestling, judo, MMA, any kind of combat sport, very intense. And if none of you have ever done those type of sports, believe me, it can be really intense, especially if you go to competitive tournaments. So this gives you a mental and physiologic edge that I've never been able to get with any other type of training.
Now, something
this type
else,
of, you know, where you combine the strength and the endurance and the cardiorespiratory work, or metabolic conditioning, it really gives you a huge conditioning edge.
A lot of people don't appreciate it. There are so many people that believe that you have to train this way. You got to lift weights if you want to maximize your muscular strength and increase muscle size. And then you got to do steady state activity or cardio to improve your cardiovascular metabolic conditioning. And then you got to do other stuff for flexibility and all this crap. And they think that you need all these different activities. They don't understand that the whole purpose of the cardiovascular system is to support the work, or primary purpose, support the work being done by your muscles. If you're working your muscles hard enough, you are going to work the heart as hard as it can be. Actually, and we talked about it with McGuff. So, and, you know, you saw that. I don't want to rehash all that unless you want to get into it. But yeah, anybody who doubts the metabolic demand that you can create with strength training hasn't done it correctly, or at least hasn't done it in a fashion that is specifically designed to address both of those things.
My conditioning workouts were always way harder than the actual bouts, so that the actual competition was almost easy, almost pleasurable. I never gassed. One thing that happened to me early, though, the old Nautilus machines were fairly well designed, but those old cams,
yeah,
they were made for excessive momentum, and you were encouraged to move a lot faster than we later learned is desirable. But one of the things that happened to me in the beginning, I had been an avid weightlifter, did a lot of squats and bent, you know, your traditional barbell exercises. And when I would go back from the machines to my barbell exercises, my weight went down. And at first I thought, you know, everyone would say, oh, because the machines make you weaker. What I didn't realize was how much skill was involved in lifting heavy weights. Yeah. And that to be good at lifting heavy weight, you got to lift heavy weight. And that when I did the machine training, my skills for handling heavy barbells eroded somewhat. Didn't mean I was weaker, because I could feel how strong I was. My weights were going up on the machines. When I would get in the mat, I felt like a beast, but yet the barbell was going down. And it took me a while to figure out, like, I'm not practicing the skill of handling the barbell. Yeah. And it's amazing how quickly their skills will go down.
A lot of people don't appreciate, because they think that if you're doing a barbell exercise, you're testing your strength. but you're actually testing your strength and your skill in the specific barbell exercise. And if you use free weights, or if you use machines, or if you use body weight or statics, or even, you know, bands, if you use it correctly, eventually you're going to get about as strong as your genetics will allow. But the only way to maximize your ability to use a particular tool, including, you know, barbells, is to practice those specific exercises. And people underestimate how much the skill affects that. Because I've seen this before. People have been, you know, working out for a while, and then they go on vacation, and there's no, you know, training studio wherever they are that I would be comfortable referring them to. So they end up going to a gym. They don't have the same machines. And I tell people, most machines are crap. They're poorly designed.
Very poorly designed.
A good machine is usually your best option. But a barbell properly used is better and safer than an improperly designed machine. And most gyms don't have properly designed machines, but they do have barbells. They go and they train with the barbells, and they say, you know what? I feel like I've just, you know,
like I'm a beginner, I'm weak.
Well, they haven't been training with it, so they have not maintained that specific skill. But if they could find comparable machines, yeah, that would be, I guess, anyways.
But you're only good at what you're doing. So, you know, strength is the same thing. But some of the strongest grapplers I have ever met didn't lift weights at all. They did a lot of body weight. I had a Japanese fellow come into my jiu-jitsu school. It was called Maxwell. It was the very first Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu Academy on the Eastern Seaboard before Renzo Gracie or Marcelo Garcia or any of the people in Miami or in Florida. It was Steve Maxwell. And this Japanese fellow comes in with these thick Coke bottle glasses. And, you know, he looked kind of like a little nerd, short guy, but you could tell he was pretty built. He was wearing a white belt. And we were doing throws that day, preparing for a tournament. He proceeds to launch my guys literally through the air like, oh, my God, this guy is no wipeout. Who the heck is this guy? I had one of my assistant instructors run down and do, you know, check out Mrs. Google, because he barely spoke English. So we eventually got his name. It was Yasushi Miyake. He was fourth Dan judo from Tokai University, three-time world Greco-Roman champion, All Japan champion, and an Atlanta Olympian. So I said, when the guy came back up and told me this, says, we better get to the ground before he kills somebody. So his ground fighting skills were not so good, but he was just so strong, like a little pit bull. So eventually he started to learn to speak English better. And I said, Yasushi, what do you do for your training? How are you so strong? And he said that he would do, you know, the traditional Japanese push-ups. He would do either rope climbing or pull-ups on his belt. For his legs, he would do squats with a partner on his back, sometimes carry a partner up and down stairs. For his abdominals, he would do sit-ups on a heavy bag with his legs around, like they call guard sit-up. Real basic, rudimentary stuff. I mean, nothing magic at all.
You're hitting all the major muscle groups.
He was hitting all the major muscle groups. And, of course, he did a huge amount of randori, or sparring, and what they call ushikomi, where you just repeatedly throw. I mean, just try throwing somebody 50 times in a row on a crash pad and tell me if you don't get a workout. So he was working his skill sets, doing two strength workouts with just pretty much body weight. And when I introduced him to some barbell training and some kettlebell stuff, he had zero skill. He couldn't handle it. He couldn't balance it. You know, we had to start with super lightweight. So the point of that story is, here's one of the strongest guys I have ever faced on the mat. I mean, literally super strong, that built it through just simple body weight exercises. And when it came to weightlifting, he didn't have the skill sets. Within a few months, I'm sure he would have had it. But the actual transferable strength was extremely high from what he was doing. Was it the best way to do it? No. I mean, there's better ways.
Yeah.
He didn't know anything about exercise. He just put this together himself. But my point is, it doesn't have to be rocket science. You know, simple push-pull, doesn't matter.
Well, for putting it together himself, it's not bad. He's got his pull, he's got his push, he's got his leg exercises, maybe not optimal.
Oh, not optimal.
Efficient.
Is efficiency.
But covering most of the neck.
Well, he would do the traditional neck bridges, which I don't I don't advocate.
No,
but he would do
neck bridges. But he had it covered.
He did the bridging gymnastics. He would flip. And like, it's typical Greco-Roman kind of neck stuff. Not that anyone should be doing that, by the way.
Yeah.
I stopped my neck bridging back, you know, in the late 1970s. I realized,
We'll get to some neck and grip training stuff. Actually, you know, something, and we were talking about this yesterday. It's interesting. I don't know if a lot of people know. You mentioned working with Hoist Gracie during those earlier UFCs.
Well,
what kind of training were you having him do back then?
I introduced Hoist to his original wife. She was a trainer. Ken Hutchins came into my gym exercise in late 1990. Maybe it was 91, not 90. You actually came for the public seminar. Was that 1990 or 91? You brought a very, very beautiful girlfriend with you, man.
I think that.
And you showed me some pretty cool exercises.
Trying to remember which is.
You were right.
None of them were bad looking.
Bodybuilding.
But it might have been, that might have been 97?
No. This was real early. Yeah, no. I've been talking to Ken pretty, just before I opened my gym in January of 1990. And I'd already been talking to Ken. This is probably like 89, when he had the old blue manual.
It would have been, well, with me, actually, I got one of the old.
Yeah, that was
the old blue ones.
That was
original super slow, way back.
Well, anyway, it was very early. Ken came, did a seminar. Drew, you were there. A lot of famous who's who. You know, Joe Waldman was there. It was like a who's who of people in the HIT community. And then Ken later stayed for the week, retrofitted some of my old vintage Nautilus with wooden and plastic cams. Also helped me alter a couple of pieces of hammer strength equipment to make it more suitable for smaller people.
Ken Leisner's?
Yeah, Ken. It was Ken Leisner. I bought a whole line of hammer strength from Ken Leisner. And then he certified us. We were like the first group to get certified in super slow. Did the written test, the practical test. That practical was like, Ken would make you work him out, and he would do every stupid mistake you could possibly do. Well, maybe not stupid for a person that doesn't know, but I mean, he would purposely mess up to make sure that you would catch it and make the corrections. It was probably as good a test as any test I've ever seen. Certainly as good as anything I ever had in my four-year college in physical education. Very valuable. So at any rate, Hoist's ex-wife, Marianne, was one of those trainers that got certified. And then I later introduced her to Hoist. They had this big love affair. He took her out to California, lost one of my best trainers. And when he was chosen to do the first UFC, and that was in 1993 in Denver, about 6 months before that, Horion wanted me to condition Hoist, and we did super slow. And Hoist was not a particularly strong guy in that when I say strong, he had amazing leverage strength. He had long, thin, lean arms, no genetic potential for muscle mass whatsoever. Long levers,
lanky.
They have very short muscle bellies, amazing endurance, great flexibility, great mindset, but no potential for size and strength as far as weightlifting strength. But on the mat, those long lever arms were a nightmare, and he was able to generate a lot of force. But we just did real simple, pretty much body weight, super slow, because he didn't have the equipment. Sometimes I would use the hammer strength and some Nautilus, but a lot of body weight because he needed a program when you go back home. And then his wife would teach. But yeah, that's how we trained. And he was amazing. I mean, what he did was amazing. I mean, here he was, this 176 pounds soaking wet, fighting guys like 40 to 80 pounds heavier.
Did he beat Dan Severn?
He did. No. Yeah.
Who was massive.
Dan was a huge Greco-Roman wrestler, 80 pounds heavier, and they caught him in a triangle. And it was unfortunate because the pay-per-view time window had already been up, and it, for many customers, it blanked out.
Wow.
And they, people were really mad. They're demanding their money back. It took Hoist a long time to cook that gun, because one of the techniques of jiu-jitsu, when you're fighting a bigger, stronger, faster guy, is to tire the guy out. And Hoist fatigued him to the point where he choked him with a triangle choke, which is with your legs around the neck and arm, and the guy had to tap out. But a lot of people missed that, and there was a huge furor. It was a bit of a mess, but it was a real tribute to Hoist's mental toughness. But part of that was developed through these extreme high-intensity training protocols that he did.
I think, again, and we were talking about body weight a little bit earlier. I think a lot of people don't appreciate how demanding this stuff is when it's done correctly, because they've never learned how. They're doing the typical, it's up, down,
gym
up,
stuff,
down.
Yeah. Or like in the military, right? You're flying through the thing. I gave a workshop at the Commando Temple in London, and there was a young guy that had a hell of a physique. And of course, he had his shirt off to make sure everyone knew he had a hell of a physique. And he jumped up on this bar and he knocked out 21 pull-ups. Impressive. Yeah. I mean, no matter how fast anyone that could do 21 pull-ups, if you've ever been in the military or you've done high school fitness tests, that's a high number.
Good amount.
But I had my guy jump up there who was equally fit, and he did 4 seconds up, 2 second hold, 4 seconds down, slow turnaround. Maybe his reps were taking like maybe 12 seconds per. Did five reps. Pretty impressive. So the guy that did the 21 was like ba-boom, ba-boom. Wasn't kipping, but it was a lot of momentum. He had like maybe 44-second time under him. My guy had well over a minute, five reps. Which goes to show you, it isn't the number of reps, it's how you do those reps. And people don't get it if they've never done it that way.
And you've probably seen this, and I see this on social media constantly. People are like, the X rep challenge, or like, do X reps of this or X reps of that. Sometimes it's a body weight exercise, sometimes it's with weight, with some multiplier body weight. And they're so focused on how many reps, but the quality is garbage.
Pretty bad.
And the focus on the reps is the problem. They're thinking about making the weight go up and down. They're thinking about what they're doing to the weight, or if it's a body weight exercise, they're thinking about making their body move. But if your goal is to improve physically, you want to focus on what you're doing to your muscles with your body weight or the weight, rather than what you're doing to the weight with your muscles. And as far as an example, And you know what I'm talking about, because you've been doing a lot with statics, is people have this idea that volume is about mechanical work, making the weight go up and down. But if you hold a mid-range position of a squat, or if you take a barbell and hold it in the middle of a curl for a minute, well, zero reps. If you don't lift and lower it, it's zero reps, but you're still forcing the muscles to contract to be able to maintain that position. And even if you're going slow, if you take like 10 seconds to lift and lower, that's 3 reps a minute, but you're doing more work in terms of metabolic work and making your muscles produce tension than somebody that does 10 reps in like 10 to 15 seconds, just
flying
up, down, up, down.
Well, you've mentioned this many times, for your newer viewers that haven't seen some of the, by the way, go to the video library, because everything we're talking about has already been covered at some point, but a lot of new guys. But I lost my train of thought.
We're talking about the command.
But with these fitness tests, like Navy SEAL training or military training, is very popular right now. A lot of people done
camps.
A lot of in the boot camp. I've seen signs around here for boot camps. People don't get that those boot camps are designed to break you. They want to weed out non-hackers. It's a selection bias. It's a selective process that only the toughest mental, physical people get through to the real spec ops training. But the boot camps are just to beat the shit out of you, make you so exhausted that you quit. They want you to quit. So no one really trains that way. One of my clients, a friend of mine, his name is Brian Musselman. He's a commander for SEAL. I don't know which SEAL team. I was going to say six, but I don't know. He's in Virginia Beach. He's a SEAL commander. He was telling me that the guys get really good at cheating the exercises.
Well, I can imagine.
You know, like when you're forced to do for police and law enforcement or military, you get good at being really efficient at the exercises. Like the guy in the command of the temple, you can rack out 20, 21 pull-ups. Well, maybe not that many, but there's a skill to it. You learn to use as little energy as possible to get those reps in so that you're not even getting a good workout. I used to do that.
Well, it's testing versus exercise.
Yeah, testing. And every workout was like a test. You know, in my younger days, we used to actually have a fitness competition team. We'd go to Hershey, Pennsylvania. We did the Marine Corps physical fitness test. This was huge during the 1960s. And we would actually have Marine Corps drill sergeants that would administer the test to teams. But you got so good at doing those exercises, where you're using a minimum amount of energy. Later on, when I learned super slow and I started doing some of the same exercises, whoa, what a difference, man. If you, yeah, you know, I used to do like in one set, like 80, 82 push-ups, which isn't bad. But man, if I could do like 4 or 5 super slow push-ups, wow.
People have no idea.
They have no idea. And interestingly enough, when I used to do the faster reps, you know, in the multiple sets, the time under load was actually less in some cases. Even when I was doing pull-up ladders to get good at pull-ups, you know, you do one, then rest, and two to, you know, supposedly building some kind of neurological efficiency and greasing the groove, they call it. I added up like all my times, and it ended up being just about 3.5 minutes. And I did 50 reps. I added all those ladders together. Figuring, you know, because it was going pretty fast. It wasn't even more than, you know, 5 minutes, 50 reps. So what's that tell you? Very inefficient.
Yeah.
And the wear and tear on your joints, boys. I'm telling you right now, you guys listening, I've made a lot of stupid mistakes with this crap. You know, I knew about proper training as of 1989, and I went with it for many, many years. And I veered away like a lot of guys do. There was a lot of attacks in Ken Hutchins personally. There was a lot of attacks in Super Slow. Kind of like the attacks that were Arthur Jones.
Yeah.
People were really in an uproar. And so anyway, like many people, I got swayed. Started veering into other forms of training. I got into kettlebells for about a decade and club bells. All I can tell you is, the wear and tear in your joints makes these things unsustainable. I've pretty much screwed up this right shoulder.
Yeah, I heard it the other day.
Kettlebells, you heard it. I developed the osteoarthritis, osteophyte. It's just not a sustainable way to train. Does it work? Yeah, sure. You get results from any of this stuff. Is it something that you want to do over a lifetime? Absolutely not. Definitely not a long-term way to train.
I've told people, and I've said it, I don't, probably more than anything else, is there are so many different ways to train that are effective. Anything. You got to have 5 things. If you want to get results, you need to train hard, you need to train progressively, and you need to do it consistently. And the volume and frequency needs to not exceed what your body is able to recover from and adapt to. If you've got those 5 things, you're going to get bigger, you're going to get stronger. Anything that fits is going to work, but a lot of it is not very safe. A lot of it is not very time efficient. And if there's a bunch of ways that are equally effective, and again, if hard, progressive, consistent, without more volume and frequency than your body can handle, you're going to get as big and strong eventually as your genetics will allow. But they're not all equally safe, and they're not all equally time efficient, and your long-term joint health matters. And if you're a younger guy listening to this, you probably, oh, they're full of shit. No, absolutely not. You do not want to end up decades down the line regretting doing a bunch of dumb shit in the gym now when you could be training more safely. So if it all works, Again, if it fits those five things. But if a bunch of things work equally well, you take the safest. In a bunch of, if a bunch of things are equally safe and effective, you choose the most time efficient. And especially, this is something that I wanted to ask you about, because you know, I've got some clients who are doing Thai boxing or Jiu Jitsu. And one of the things that is difficult for a lot of people is keeping up with a demanding class schedule. And you know, if you're sparring, if you're doing hard drilling, it takes its toll. And pretty being awesome. Able to work the and still work out around it. And most people don't realize that there's only so much your body can handle of any activity within some time frame. And if you're doing too much, you are going to overtrain. You're not going to get stronger. You're not going to improve your conditioning. It's going to get worse. But here's the thing. If you had to choose, if you wanted to get somebody as good as possible, if you could spend more time on the mat and less time in the gym, that would be advantageous, I would imagine.
Well, you definitely hit it right on the head. The majority of your time, if you're a martial artist, should be spent in the dojo, the academy, in the ring. There's no two ways about it. Skill is your number one priority. And a highly skilled person can overcome a person that's actually bigger and stronger. But you want to be as strong as you absolutely can and as skilled as you can. But how do you fit it all together? Because as you said, a lot of these things, especially grappling, is very demanding. It's a form of resistance training. You know, what I found at Max's is that we tried everything. More than two supplemental strength workouts would lead to gross overtraining. And that depends how many times you're getting on the mat. For guys that only getting there twice a week, three times a week, you know, they can maybe get away with a little bit more strength training. But if you were training four or five times a week on the mat, once a week was all you're going to be able to handle. And we tried it, with every kind of person you could imagine, men, women, older guys, younger guys. And that's one reason why you don't see too many guys over 45. You know, most of the people that are over 45 in martial arts started when they were like 45 or 50. You see some people like that. But people that started like me when I was like, I don't know, I was 10 years old when I did PV wrestling, you don't usually last that long. And I attribute the strength training to my longevity, but I did veer off a little bit from the path and got myself a little bit messed up. Figure this way, your martial arts training is stressful enough on your joints. There's no, you can't get around it. That's part of the game. You go in there knowing you probably are going to get hurt. I mean, you just accept that as with martial art. For your strength training, it should be as non-stressful to your joints as possible. You want it to be high intensity. You want it to be really hard, but there's no reason to erode joint health with your strength training. And that's a big mistake a lot of guys do with their box jumps and their barbell power cleans and all that stuff. Does it work? Yeah, sure. You'll get results, but it's unsustainable. Joint erosion, end your career early. So that's one reason why I was thrilled to see the isometrics come full circle and come back. Because that's something I did as a young wrestler in high school. It's just that it's not glamorous. It's not sexy. You know,
you're not moving big weights.
You're not moving big weights.
Yeah.
And with the time static contraction, unless you have a force gauge, you don't even know how much you're doing. It doesn't make it any less effective. And if you have the mental capacity to still go beyond that and kind of get into the Zen strength training, where you're just training to momentary muscular exhaustion. I'm huge in the isometrics right now.
I don't think most people appreciate just how effective it. Well, again, it's like bodyweight training. It's like a lot of things. Until they've done it correctly or been taught how to do it correctly and actually do it with the required intensity of effort, most will not appreciate how effective it can be. And I could go on and on with examples, but while I'm talking to you, I want your examples. Now,
it's interesting because just last week I was in Port Townsend. There was a young fellow that came in and said he was a strength coach for the U.S. Olympic judo team in Boston. It's Jimmy Pedro's school. Jimmy Pedro, in case you don't know, was a medalist for the U.S., which is unusual because usually the U.S. sucks in judo. But, we had this one guy that was – we had a woman that this past – Olympics in Rio. They did an amazing job. We also had Ronda Rousey. But usually U.S. is not real high in the judo ranking. But this young guy came in from Jimmy Pedro's school, and they've changed a lot of their exercise philosophy. They're doing isometrics now, and isometrics work. I can remember in the 60s, isometrics were hugely popular. Bob Hoffman. Yeah, in fact, that's where the power rack came from. A power rack was originally made, they called it the isometric power rack, to hold barbells against pins for time. Short time.
I remember he had the real narrow racks, and you had pairs of pins for it.
And they had one rack where you could thrust a bar in the hole and just use it without weight. And then they had the double pins where you would lift the weight from the bottom pin to the top pin and hold for time. And of course, they were into the three different positions because they were short duration. And you would do like maybe the extreme range on Monday, mid range on Tuesday, and the
kind of stretch position.
Yeah, the stretch position, like on Friday. But Ken Hutchins, with his genius, figured a much better way of doing it with the time static contraction. But yeah, there's a little portable exercise, isometric things. My dad bought me for my birthday. I can remember using that thing. It works.
Yeah. I know one of the concerns that a lot of people have about isometrics is the specificity of strength gains to the position change. Now, looking at the research, it's mixed. There's studies that show there's no specificity, and there's some that show there is. I suspect that a lot of these studies that are showing specificity are not showing specific strength gains, but again, with exercise performance, it's the combination of strength and skill in the test.
In the test.
Because I haven't seen that. I've seen people that have just been doing statics go back to machine or free weight exercises or body weight. And if the strength was specific to the position trained, you'd expect for them to always hit failure in the weaker positions.
And they don't.
If the resistance curve matches the strength curve, then failure will occur at random positions throughout, or more likely at the start on the pushing movements, because sometimes you just lose it on the way down and can't get it going. But have you seen problems with the strength from the isometrics not transferring?
I haven't seen that at all. Most positions in grappling are mid-range anyway, for the most part.
I suppose you want to avoid the extremes.
Yeah, and you want to avoid this, man. You know, anytime you're extending your arms, you're just asking for it. So, you know, I don't know about the striking arts, but for sure.
Well, same. You don't want to be
in grappling. You don't want to extend your limbs. So I haven't seen that at all. I have seen good transfer and excellent transfer in a very safe way. One of the things I like about the isometrics, you don't feel beat up at all. Not at all. Now, I did a body weight workout with the UXS yesterday.
Post a picture later.
And wow, it kicked my butt. I basically did a workout no stop. And man, you can't tell from the video because I'm controlling my breathing, but my heart rate, and I was breathing so hard. It wasn't even my heart rate. It was just the breath. The respiratory system was having a heck of a time. And it was really stressful. And I feel pretty tired today. I'll still get the same metabolic stress, but somehow the isometrics, I find I can recover a little bit faster. I don't know whether you found this, but
it's like most things, it seems to vary between individuals, but there with the isometrics, you might not have as much of the microtrauma, as much of the muscle damage, which does seem to prolong recovery a little bit. So might not that people need to train a lot more frequently, but if they wanted to, it would allow them to do it without overtraining.
And there's nothing wrong with mixing the two. I mean, I think the perfect marriage is you take your body weight training, the Kratos, mixed with the isometrics to fill in some of the gaps. For example, some people can't do pike push-ups. You heard my shoulder cracking yesterday.
Yeah.
So notice I didn't do the pike push-up. I did the lateral raise from this position. So you can mix and match. If you have an injury, you can easily work around that injury. I mean, I had a guy come to me the other day, a young jiu-jitsu guy. I hurt my shoulder, and he wanted to cancel his workout. I says, wait a second. You still have the left arm and two legs. You still have your torso muscles. Let's just do it. And ended up that if I kept his elbows to his side, he was able to do a pain-free lateral raise. I found that he could do a pain-free chest crush. He was able to do pull downs, no problem. You know,
a lot of times with the time static contraction, well, if a person has a joint condition or if they have an injury, if you have them go through the movement and make a note of where there's some aggravation, you just have them perform the time static contraction in a position that's a little away from that. So that, and also the nice thing about time static contraction, for those of you who aren't familiar, a time static contraction is not like traditional isometrics. You know, the old isometrics, you would just lay on as hard as you could for about 5 to 10 seconds, then back off and then repeat that a couple times. A timed static contraction is a longer continuous effort. You start with a moderate effort and you build up to that over a few seconds, and then you hold a moderate effort for about 30 seconds. Then, without stopping to rest, you increase until you're contracting almost as hard as you can for another 30 seconds. Then, again, without stopping to rest, you increase your effort until you're contracting as hard as you dare, as hard as you feel you can safely contract, or as hard as you can stand it, and maintain that effort for the last 30 seconds. And especially with some of the exercises like the hip belt squats, it will absolutely destroy just, your muscles. It'll wipe you out, but your joints, nothing.
Here's one of the things that I really like about isometrics for specifically for grappling, whether it's submission grappling or Brazilian jiu-jitsu or judo. You learn to breathe while under tremendous tension. There's a real problem with a lot of beginner grapplers where they'll use what I call Valsalva sink, where it's like a you hear this grunting. It's to be avoided at all costs. You're getting this huge spike in negative stress hormones. You're jacking your blood pressure up like something awful. You could stroke out or have an aneurysm, you know, if you have any kind of hidden conditions. And you get tired really fast. Better to be able to breathe continuously while the muscles are under tension. Time static contractions teach that. I know that we've talked about this before, and you've talked about this before. You don't want to try to duplicate skills with strength training, like a weighted implement to, you know, like a weighted baseball bat or, you know, weighted football or something. I mean, it makes no sense. It just causes motor learning confusion. However, the breath work, it's the same. I breathe on the mat almost identical to the way I breathe in the time static contraction, almost identical to the way I perform the Kratos exercises. You learn to breathe while under tremendous tension. And interestingly enough, if I have some heavy dude laying on top of me, you know, kind of compressing my ribs, which is almost the same thing as when I'm contracting my torso, you can breathe even with a heavy weight on you and not panic, not freak out, you know, and it definitely prolongs your endurance. You don't get so tired. So it's a huge benefit to grapplers specifically, and obviously any fighter, MMA guys, you know, getting in the clinch or whatever. You learn to breathe. So many beginners.
People need to, too.
It's unbelievable, man.
You can hear it sometimes. And again, we could go on and on about real quick, for those of you who are not familiar with this, the typical advice to inhale while you're lowering and exhale while you're lifting and all this stuff is just, it's nonsense. And you don't need to, and you shouldn't be holding your breath or performing Valsalva's maneuver during exercise. Practicing a competitive lift is a different thing, but that's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about a competitive lift. We're talking about performing the exercise, not to see how much weight you can lift or to show other people how much weight you can lift, but to use the weight to efficiently load your muscles without wrecking your joints in the process. Instead of trying to match your breathing to your reps. And in fact, if you're moving slowly enough during an exercise, you might do at most 6 or 7 reps per minute. If you're doing more than 6 or 7 reps per minute, you're going too fast. If you're working hard enough though, you might need to take, you know, 2-3 times as many breaths per minute or more than that. You can't time it. You can't time it if you're moving slow enough and working hard enough. Instead, you just want to breathe as relaxed as naturally as possible. and just let your mouth hang open, just almost like a dog panting. But if you're holding your breath, you're bearing down like that, or especially when you hear these people go, you can't even make the noise. If you're breathing correctly, you shouldn't hear anything other than just that ha panting sound. So yeah, don't hold your breath. Don't try to match your breathing to your lowering and lifting movements. Just breathe as relaxed, as naturally as possible. And I know somebody's going to come in, well, you got to, you know, have that extra pressure in your abdomen to be able to maintain rigid torso during deadlift and squat. Not if you are using a weight that you can handle in really strict form. Again, we're not talking about
a max
efforts. Yeah. If you're using an appropriate weight for a strict rep for a long enough duration, you're going to be able to hold your torso rigid without relying on Valsalva's maneuver, or without that breath holding and tightening up.
Or even a brace or a weight belt. You can just do it naturally. But you know, like you said, there will be people saying, well, how about like a really heavy deadlift? Well, A, you don't need to do really heavy deadlifts. But if you are inclined to do this type of, you know, single, double, or triple, yeah, obviously. We're not saying that Valsalva wouldn't help you. But no one ever said it's healthy either. Yeah. Well, it's probably shaving years off the end of your life.
You're better off just avoiding it during exercise. Yeah, just breathe.
Absolutely. But another issue that comes up with martial arts in particular is flexibility. One of the, I don't want to say weaknesses, but with time static contraction, you do need to do some extra stretching if you're a martial artist. I mean, if you're just like a regular Joe, you don't need a whole lot of this stuff. But if you are engaged in a martial art where you need a pretty flexible body, obviously you're going to have to do a little extra stretching. With the Kratos, you don't need it as much because you're getting that full
if you're
full range.
Moving at all.
But here's something about flexibility. My most flexible students over the years were my most injured students. I had some guys that could do some amazing flexible stunts. I had this one kid that could do, we call him roadkill split, where you go out to the side and lay your upper body down. He could do what was it called, Chinese splits. I mean, it was like pretty a flexible guy. He could even put both feet crossed behind his neck. That kid was injured all of the time. And part of the reason was he didn't have the accompanying strength in these extreme positions. People would put his limbs in positions where he didn't have the accompanying strength, and he was getting a lot of bad injuries as the result. And his joints started becoming loose as he got a little bit older. It's interesting because I did a Jiu Jitsu seminar in Philly, and the guy came up to me and he says, you know, Steve, I finally got what you were telling me all those years. He said, people talk about, like in martial arts, using power and strength over skill. He says, but there's a subset of people in martial arts, particularly jiu-jitsu, that use flexibility over technique. He says, I was one of those guys that over-relied on my flexibility, but he was getting a lot of joint injuries. So he said, I don't go into those extreme ranges anymore.
Ken Hutchins talked about this too, way back, because in talking about the general trainable factors of functional ability, he was always very particular to say that exercise improved flexibility, not that it increased flexibility.
Exactly.
Because for beyond some point, an increase in flexibility results in joint laxity and less stability, because you mobility versus stability. You want to have mobility, which is actually the combination of strength and flexibility, but also need that stability. And the stability comes, again, from the strength of the muscles that act on the joint, but also a certain degree of joint integrity. If you have strong enough muscles, it can make up for a little bit of laxity in the joint. But also, as you know, the closer you get to the extremes of a range of motion, the weaker the muscles are. So you don't want to be able to.
You're better off being a little bit tight. I've worked out some of the highest level jiu-jitsu guys on the planet. I worked extensively with Saul Ribeiro, particularly when he won Abu Dhabi in Sao Paulo. But I also worked a lot with his brother, Shanji. I've worked with Cron Gracie. I've worked with like some really high level guys, Ronnie Yaya, Diego Sanchez, and none of these guys were particularly flexible. They had moderate flexibility, really good motor ability because, you know, their skills. They were all very strong. They're all very strong, but they were not what I would call flexi bendy at all. So I know there's like this whole game of inversions. They call it Barambola, where you kind of roll upside down. It's very tricky to fight a guy that has this, but every one of those Barambola guys ends up with really bad spine, terrible disc problems, back problems. I just talked to Hicks and Gracie not long ago. He says he never lets anyone stack him up in the guard anymore. He'll just let him pass. I talked to Hiron Gracie about this. Hiron said the same thing. If someone's jacking me up on my neck, I just let him pass the guard. Or if I have a triangle or a umbilical, it's like the legs entangled, the arm, you can submit a guy. He said, I just let it go. So for anyone that wants to keep any kind of longevity in jiu-jitsu, do not let people stack you up on your neck. It's just not worth it. And then that goes back to the point system and all that, which I'm not even going to get into it. I'm not a big fan of IFBJJ point system, but yeah, that's just me.
I don't know enough about it to have an opinion, although I think with wrestling and with jiu-jitsu in general, you pin or you submit, and that's probably a better contest.
Well, there's this way that you can stack people up on their necks and their back, and the guys with real super flexible spines, they'll take that pressure, and sometimes they'll still even submit you. You know, but what a toll it takes in your body over time.
Would not want.
And then you couple that with stupid barbell training or stupid kettlebell training or CrossFit training, and you're getting this double whammy effect of your martial art putting a tremendous joint stress and your strength training also. And a lot of times you won't feel it. You mentioned subacute injuries all the time. You're constantly getting subacute injuries in martial arts. It's almost impossible to avoid. But if you're getting subacute injuries in the gym with Olympic barbell lifts or CrossFit-ish type kipping pull-ups or your box jumps or your kettlebell swings, you are really exacerbating the wear and tear in your joints. You're causing a tremendous amount of premature aging. Take it from a guy that just turned 67. You know, if I could turn back the clock, if I could talk to myself, I can see that getting into that whole kettlebell thing was a mistake. Here's the ironic thing, though, Drew. I've been to Russia. I've been to China. I've traveled all over the world. And it's interesting. In Russia, no one uses kettlebells. I went to Club Dynamo in Moscow. It's like a one-stop shopping for grappling. They had Russian Samba, freestyle wrestling, Greco-Roman wrestling. They had a black belt from Brazil teaching Brazilian jiu-jitsu. And I saw maybe two kettlebells in the whole place. What they had was pull-up bars and dip bars, a whole wall lined, back extensions. That's what they were doing. They were doing chins, dips, push-ups, back, a lot of body weight. They had maybe like 30 bodyweight stations along the wall. It was like, wow, it was an eye
opener. I need to contact them about the UXS.
And then I started getting into Russian martial art, Russian sistema, and I was really fascinated. They were into very slow, methodical repetitions. Sometimes 20, 30-second reps with push-ups.
It's kind of like Darden stuff.
Yeah, they were really in, they believed that they liked the – they also noticed that, you know, when you learn to breathe while under tension, and they seem to think that you can – You can learn to handle body tension better when you're going really, really slow. Well, and it's universal with Russian sistema. Slow body weight training.
Yeah, because
it's fascinating, man.
Because here, you know, in the West, a lot of people have this idea about how other cultures, like the Bulgarians and Russians and this. And I wish I could remember where I heard this, but apparently somebody that was in Russia that had asked their strength coaches about their training methods had been shown, the strength coaches showed them, a stack of American bodybuilding and weightlifting
magazines.
This was
Ted Lambernides. He was on – Ted Lambernides, who used to work for Hammer Strength. I believe he was like one of the vectors. Yep. Ted went over and talked to one of the Russian strength. It was like a symposium, an exchange. And anyway, the coach opened up a file cabinet drawer of the old muscle, Joe Weider muscle magazines. And that was where, that was their secret training.
Oh man.
One last thing about Russian training. I know I was very much involved with the RKC, the Russian Kettlebell, that Pavel Sotsolian on that. And then later he broke off and started Strong First, which is pretty popular. And Strong First is basically a, it's a sport. Your main purpose in Strong First is to see how much weight you can lift. Not your powerlifting or Olympic lifting, but particular kettlebell lifts. They have their tactical strength challenge, and they have the beast challenge, where you can do a one-legged squat, a one-arm press, and a pull-up with this really heavy kettlebell. And then the tactical thing is deadlifts, snatches, and pull-ups. It's a competition. You're lifting for the sake of being good at those lifts, but no one ever said it was healthy. And, but one last thing. Pavel mentions on Strong First that all of his principles are based on the Russian Olympic lifting system. But if you keep up with the news, you'll see that Russia is banned from world competition because they caught the guys dirty. Not that we don't use drugs in our country, but Russia made a science out of drug use. So between selection bias and survivor bias, surviving, they had a state-sponsored comprehensive drug program. That's where you're getting your Russian strength protocol. So if you want to do it clean and you don't want to get involved with performance-enhancing drugs, I'm telling you, pretty much that erases almost all those Russian strength principles.
And I want to make something real clear.
Just
here.
Saying. Probably get some hate mail on it.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, people will get upset if you criticize their pet thing. I do not discourage anybody from competing in any kind of athletics. If you enjoy powerlifting, if you enjoy Olympic lifting, kettlebell competitions, any of these things, if it is something that you get a lot of personal pleasure from participating in, do it. But don't confuse it with proper exercise. The best way to get good at powerlifting is to get coaching on proper technique for powerlifting and practice it. There's no way around it. Same with any of these other sports or competitions. The problem is when people think that these training methods for strength sports also make good exercise methods. And most of them, again, if it's hard, progressive, done consistently, and the volume and frequency don't exceed what your body can handle and recover from and adapt to, then you're going to get bigger and stronger. It's going to eventually hit your genetic limits. But these things are not nearly as safe or nearly as efficient. And the coffee is going all the way through me. So I was going to take a break real quick, but if I can turn the camera, I know you just worked out yesterday and the thighs are probably fried, but you had made comments earlier about the effectiveness of that squat with the roller compared
amazing.
To the hammer strength.
Amazing, man.
Would you, despite your legs,
I'll demo it again. One last thing too, just before we take a little pee break here. We're like these little dogs running around here.
Yeah, we got to watch out. We don't step on them.
So strength sport is not the ideal to train for other sports. So many guys think that for football or wrestling or MMA,
I'll be right back,
that they need to be doing strength sport. The skills involved with handling heavy weight, heavy barbells, even kettlebells, have no transference. The strength transfers, but the skills do not transfer. Like, I was real instrumental in the Turkish getup, which I thought was a good exercise, but is a very inefficient way to train your muscles. The time under load in any plane or any direction is very, very small. The skill of sitting up and then standing up with a weight held overhead transfers into nothing else. So I was a bit deluded with that. Is it a hard exercise? Yes. Is there some transfer? Of course. There's always some transfer. Is it the ideal way or most efficient way to do it? No, it is not. So I'm going to take a quick break and then I'll be right back.
Yeah, probably should have skipped the second cup of coffee. This
I just mentioned like the turkeys get up. Well, there's no skills involved with doing these lifts. Have no transfer in the sport.
I'm gonna go through some of the questions here real quick. And
yeah.
All right, so we're not done, everybody. First thing we did here earlier was have a bunch of coffee. So I probably should have skipped the second one. So I'm going to start going through some of the questions real quick here to see what we got, and then pick a few. We're going to, when Steve gets back, demonstrate that squat if he's up for it. And let's see here. Okay. So just reading everybody's questions or comments, just looking for some of the questions. Okay, here's a good one. Somebody's asking, I understand, and I'll let Steve answer some of these too, but I understand the safety of slower reps and the potential of muscle growth, but how does training slow help with movements that tend to be explosive? Well, here's the thing. The explosiveness in other activities doesn't require you to move explosively during strength training. There's no transfer from one to the next. Your ability to accelerate quickly depends on the force your muscles can produce. As a muscle gets stronger, it is capable of producing more force, and that can be used in any other activity. In fact, I'll give you an example. Suppose that the most you can press overhead one time is 100 pounds. If the most you can press is 100 pounds, you're not going to be able to do it very quickly. But if you take 50 pounds, you're going to be able to move it up and down pretty fast. 50% of your one rep max, you're going to be able to toss up and down very quickly. Now, if you get strong enough that your new one rep max is 200, you will then be able to move the 100 that you could only move slowly before as fast as you used to be able to move the 50, and you'll be able to move the 50 even faster. The strength from exercise, regardless of whether you use fast or slow movements, or even if you use isometrics, if you train with statics, which is as slow as it gets, as long as the muscles are stronger and they can produce more force, they will allow you to accelerate more quickly in other activities. But to maximize the explosiveness, you have to take the strength you get from your workouts and pair it with the skill of practicing these specific activities correctly at speed. If you want to improve your explosiveness and throwing a jab or a hook or anything like that, you have to first get the body mechanics down. And then while consistently practicing it with correct body mechanics, you have to work on doing it faster. You have to have the skill, but you don't have to move fast to develop the strength to use during that. And let's see if we got other. I don't know if you wanted to comment on it. Somebody's asking about the transfer of. Well, actually, from a practical standpoint, because you've been using slow reps for a while. In fact, you trained Hoist Gracie with super slow, and now doing combination of slow and static training. Has it in any way slowed you or any of your trainees down?
Not at all. As a matter of fact, even in good jiu-jitsu teaching. Also, this applies to the Russian martial arts. Everything's done super slow. You do all your techniques slow, very slow. And then you very gradually begin to build up the speed. It's very if you try to do things too quickly, you miss so many of the little details. So you really get it hardwired in your nervous system by doing repetition, slow training. And that transfers into lightning quick. It's all about timing anyway.
Slow is smooth, smooth is fast.
Smooth is fast. And I can remember in my early days of jiu-jitsu, and I was a good wrestler. So, I couldn't believe that this skinny Brazilian guy was kicking my ass so bad.
Yeah, turn the suit.
But he would actually sometimes wrestle me slow motion. And his timing was so good, and his precision was so good, and he was so smooth that I would see it coming, and I still couldn't stop it.
I could see how the timing would almost be more important than the speed in some cases.
The actual speed. And this goes way back, grapplers have known this forever. I would also like to address the stunts and feats, like the human flag or or iron cross. Oh,
iron cross.
You know, people talk about
levers,
strength. As a kid in the 60s, we used to have a gymnastics club. We didn't actually have a competition team, but we did have a club. And you actually got a chance to get out of school for an hour and go and practice the gymnastics in the gym. It was a club.
It'd be nice.
Yeah. Instead of doing like a study hall or some other boring thing, you could go. And
we still have that. Kids spend too much time sitting on
much time sitting
polishing there. A seat with their ass instead of moving around.
Or texting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't even get me started. The teachers can't even take the phone from the kids anymore. Yeah. And the kids will be there texting during class. Well, anyway. As a former teacher, I taught a few years in the public school system. But anyway, it was always a race. And we trained year-round, played sports. I was a three-letter. I played football, wrestling, track and field, did gymnastics club. So I was training year-round. And it was always a race to see who could get the Iron Cross because the gymnastics club is only a couple months every year. So we would work up to the point where we could do an Iron Cross. That was like the big move with us kids. But you would lose it almost within a week or two of not practicing it. Oh. It's the same thing with your bench, your squat, your deadlift. What you don't practice, you will lose that skill very, very quickly. And a lot of times people think, oh, I'm getting weaker. No, we were strong as could be. We just didn't have that specific strength skill. And the other thing, while we're, I haven't heard you address this, but the secret prison training systems, what a crock. It's, you got to
cut. There are no, oh yeah, you can.
It's total bullshit.
It's bullshit. There are no secret prison training systems. The guys that are going in there and that are working out in the prisons that haven't removed the weight, and I don't know if they still, but I actually, unfortunately, there have been some prisons that have removed the weights, apparently because of them being used for bludgeons or other things.
Or they also don't want to create super criminals. There is a thought in some of the prison systems, they don't want to make super strong prisoners, especially these violent guys that have committed assaults and murders and rapes. They don't want these guys getting super strong and, and the guards, of course, are always worried.
I would imagine as a guard. In fact, I know I've got a couple clients. I've got a bunch of readers that are in corrections. So if any of you guys that work in corrections want to chime in with any comments on this, let me know. But from what I know from actually talking with, and I'm not going to talk about any particular individuals, but fortunately, I know some people that either didn't get a good lawyer or made some mistakes and spent time in the prison system. And they weren't doing any kind of super secret special convict
system. Condition.
Yeah.
It's a crock.
It was.
It's a fraud. The convict squats. Condition, I'll say it. It's a fraud. You know, I like the Cavallo brothers. I think they're amazing athletes. But that whole convict conditioning is based in crap. The so-called author, no one's ever seen this guy. No one's ever heard of it. I corresponded pen pal with a guy that was in San Quentin, the big house. In California, and he was interested in picking my brain. Everything had to be handwritten. It was really tedious because I hadn't written for years, and I'm writing these letters to this guy. Yeah. Oh my god, because I would write these letters to this guy, and we'd go correspond back and forth. And he said that you very rarely see good physiques in prison. Most of the guys are fat because they're eating. Cookies and stuff from the commissary.
Yeah.
They have horrible diet. There are some genetic freaks, like in any population, that will rise to the top no matter what they do. Some guys wouldn't even do anything. They still look better than the average guy. He said a lot of these guys are hurting themselves, especially these big burpee programs. He said he saw a huge amount of guys crippled up with lower back pain. And many of these guys, because of the excessive, because they have nothing to do. Some of the guys are training every day. They end up with terrible joint wear and tear. And a lot of the lifers or long-termers, they end up with terrible arthritis in their backs and their knees and their hips from doing these excessive convict conditioning workouts. But
I'm going to say it right now since you brought up burpees. Burpees are one of the dumbest things that you can do. Just stupid. The only reason to ever do burpees is if you want to get better at doing burpees.
I suppose if you're going to Marine Corps boot camp or whatever, you might want to practice it only if, you know, I don't think it's even a test anymore. It used to be a test.
I hope not, because it's a dumb thing. It's a stupid thing. It does not efficiently load any of the muscle groups that are involved. You're alternating between the push-up movement, popping up into the squat position, doing the jump, coming back down your back. You'd be better off doing a proper push-up and a proper squat without all the jumping nonsense.
Just go back and forth between the two if you had to.
Do push-ups, do squats, and then repeat, but don't alternate between a rep of each. Especially, and if you watch most people when they do it, when they transition from the push-up to the squat, they throw their hips forward as they're popping up, rapidly moving into flexion of the spine. So that's where you get your back issues with it. And then the jumping, there's no reason to ever do jumping during exercise. You want to move in a slow and controlled manner and maintain relatively consistent tension on all of the muscles being targeted while minimizing acceleration to keep the forces encountered within a relatively low, within a safe range. There is no general physical benefit that you can obtain from doing burpees that you cannot get from other safer exercises.
I'll tell you something, you know, people like burpees because they make them breathe hard. I could barely get enough oxygen yesterday when I did the
UXS, the squats.
Oh my God. And no, I mean, just the whole workout, it was like, wow, I felt like a 10-minute Jiu Jitsu match.
Yeah.
From the breath point of view.
Yeah. People don't understand that, because they think, you think about metabolic conditioning and you usually picture people, you know, moving real fast, trying to perform as much mechanical work as possible, when they don't realize that the reason that there's metabolic stress is not necessarily because of how much movement the muscles are producing, but how much tension. And you can just literally hold a weight motionless, or you can move slowly. As long as the muscles are contracting hard enough, they have to use energy to produce that force. And so you can have a very high metabolic demand with a very low rate of work, very low. You don't need high power output. You don't need a lot of mechanical work to create a significant metabolic demand, and through that affect the cardiovascular system. In fact, some of the worst, I shouldn't say worst, but the worst feeling in terms of the metabolic effect has come from doing the hip belt squats with timed static contraction, zero movement, especially when I started experimenting with them, when I was doing them at parallel. Those were torturous.
I could barely make it. I couldn't keep the chain or the belt tight when I did parallel. I mean, at the end, I was just sinking.
Yeah, people have no idea. And you know what? And I'm going to grab the platform. I'm going to grab the belt. Just throw it out here. I don't know if people will be able to see. I can turn the camera. I've got a platform that I made. And I've got all my bands on top of it right now. I'm moving to this. And this platform is actually to give me a little more range of motion during the deadlifts.
It's something that, that's nice. See it.
But yeah, put this platform together. I'll set it right there.
That's a beauty.
And where is the dipping belt? Back over
it's
here.
It's right over there beside the yeah.
So this dipping belt. Get this on here. If you've got a dip belt, you can build this out of wood. I've got a platform that I'm standing on that has a carabiner in it. And when this is hooked here, I will not be able to straighten out my legs. I'll get to the point where my knees are about maybe, and I'm not sure if you can see how low I am. I'll turn to the side so you can see. I'm right about, so I got a little bit 90 degrees. And with this belt, I can't come up any higher. So what I'm going to do, feet about shoulder width and sitting back a little bit, and I'm not going to do the whole thing because I've got to work out later and my thighs will be threatened. Just destroyed. I'm going to push up lightly at first, and I'm going to gradually increase my effort until I'm contracting about half as hard as I can for 30 seconds. Then I'll go up to almost as hard as I can for 30 seconds. And then for the last 30 seconds, I'll be contracting as hard as I can. But in reality, I'll be fighting just to keep that belt tight. So I'm going to pick this up so people can see what it looks like.
It's a beautiful piece of equipment. I may have to make one of my own.
This is two pieces of, I took part of really dense particle board, 3/4 inch, stacked them, glued them together with a 1/2 inch of rubber on the top. And then I've just got a U-bolt through the bottom with that. And doing those hip belt squats, and actually, since we're mentioning them, you were the one that came up with the method for doing them with the gi belt.
With my jiu-jitsu belt. I would just literally wrap the belt around my waist and stand on the ends. Similar.
Actually, I don't know if you want to demonstrate
the forearm
forklift. So I've got one.
The forearm forklift is nice because it has loops. But let's just say you guys, maybe today,
move this out of the way.
You just want to try it. And you don't have a forearm forklift. But what I came up with, I was looking for a way, I was traveling. I was a digital nomad, no home. I had no opportunity to make it. So I would just cross it and then squat and stand on one end of the belt and then stand on the other end so that my heel was on the belt. And then basically the same position that Drew was in. And what I was finding was if I went too low, I wouldn't make the 90. So the first 30 seconds, I would go slack in the belt. The second 30 seconds, the belt would be taut. And then the last 30 seconds is just as much as I could muster. I try to break the belt, but a lot of times it would end up going slack anyway because your thighs give out. Absolutely one of the best, most productive exercises I've ever done. Certainly not for the faint of heart. But, no. Man, if you want to demonstrate that you don't need – a lot of movement or explosiveness to get a good cardio workout, man. Just get yourself a belt right now or whatever and try this. See if you can make the 90 seconds. 30,
30, 30. Yeah.
Killer.
I am surprised. I'm really surprised. You know, the company that makes these, the forearm forklifts.
They should be giving you some.
Yeah, I probably sold
lifetime
a bunch for them.
I think you have, man.
These things for isometrics and like – turn this a little bit so we get everybody in. For isometrics, these things are phenomenal. You can do a ton of stuff with it. And if you ever have to move furniture, they're phenomenal for it. So, yeah, forearm forklift, if you want, send me a check for
Well, the other thing, too, is they do have these sewn-in loops that you can put your feet into so they don't slip. But I have a guy right now, a jiu-jitsu guy in London, who broke his finger. It had to have surgery and pins. So he can't grip anything for at least another month. So he's able to do like lateral. Well, you can't say
the loops are handy.
Yeah, he can do curls. He can do tricep extensions. He can put his elbow and do lateral raises. He can do pec. He can do everything without even using his grip.
They're handy.
My girlfriend's mother just broke her wrist in the fall. She's in her 80s, and I've been doing forearm forklift exercises for her. Giving her full body workout because she also, because of the surgery, can't use her hands. And with the little loops in this, you can give people a pretty phenomenal workout without even needing a grip. So perfect for working around injuries. If you have a limb that's incapacitated or a hand.
Yeah, it surprises me that the company hasn't caught on to people using them for this.
For exercise,
and started to market them for that too. But yeah, the focus is they're mainly moving straps, but they work phenomenally for a variety of isometric exercises. And doing those hip belt squats with the forearm forklifts, you can also fit your feet through the loops and just use the correct loops to get you. And if you're going to try this, do a video recording of it. And upload it and send me a link so we can see your reaction. And if you're really brave, because what you want is the back of your knees to be about 90 degrees or a little bit less. But if you're really brave, try it at parallel with your hips, about even with your knees. And while, again, 30 seconds, moderate effort, 30 seconds, almost as hard as you can, and then 30 seconds as hard as you can stand it, and see if you can even make it through the whole thing. I'm going to check. It looks like we got some more questions here.
Brutal.
Let's see here. How does it work with – hold on. going to go back up. Okay. What compound lifts are best for Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu? Oh, actually, we got a bunch more questions. Sorry, I'll try and get these in order. So is there a well, this is more of the grappling. Is there a difference between the sistema you experienced versus the big fat guy videos that appear to be on Bullshito? I don't know if you are familiar.
They're talking about, I don't want to get into martial art seminar. There's more strength and conditioning, but just in brief. The guy's name is Michael Riadko. He's a colonel in the, I think, SFB, which is the new KGB. And he's had some health issues. He was one of the trainers of Vladimir Vasiliev in Toronto. What you're seeing on the Bushido is that he has this punch where it's like Bruce Lee's one-inch punch. It's the sistema version where he can hit you literally. It doesn't look like he's applying any effort whatsoever. And that punch goes right through your middle. What you're seeing is when he's doing this and the guys are falling down, everyone in there has felt that punch. When I was at the summit of the Breathmasters in Moscow, everyone lined up to feel his punch. And I was thinking, this is bullshit. This fat fucker isn't going to knock me down. You know, I'm a fit guy and, you know, I have good abs. And I'm standing there and he just goes, bloop. And it was like, oh my God, it went right through to my spine. I literally fell on the floor and couldn't catch my breath. And the point is, those guys felt that. Now they have a fear. The whole reason for that video was he's trying to show you how you can influence people psychologically so that once they felt the sting of your punch, you just show them the fist and they literally, oh, you know.
And I think a lot of people, and this is from my very limited understanding of the mechanics of Bruce Lee's one-inch punch, a lot of people don't realize that the punch is not coming from the arms and the shoulder, but rather if you have your body set right, if you let your body weight drop, if the legs are set to cause your trunk to twist, the weight of your body dropping and the torque from that is where some of that comes from. So you don't see a lot of arm movement, but you have, and I don't know if that's what he's doing. I'm guessing based on
the a lot of relaxation. But I've trained with, a lot of different sistema masters. You know, I went to the Canary Islands, spent 2 months with Colonel Alexander Maximzov. That guy's no joke, man. That guy is somebody you would not want to mess with. You know, former KGB guy, former Soviet guy. He lives in the Canary Islands pretty much full time. I had a chance to work with Izvor Sistema in Moscow. I'm having a Michael Grudev. He's the president of the Unarmed Combat Association in Russia. That guy is hardcore. He looks like just this little dumpy fat dude. You do not want that guy punching you, and you definitely would not want to grab that guy. The sistema is for real, and it makes a really nice blend with the Brazilian jiu-jitsu. There are some things lacking in jiu-jitsu. I think the knife defenses, I wouldn't trust. Jiu-jitsu knife defenses, no good. I think the Russian stuff is fantastic. So you can take those principles and apply it to jiu-jitsu. But my point was in mentioning it, sistema guys do not use kettlebells. You know, and they're the elite. They're special ops soldiers.
Yeah, so you got to kind of be skeptical of most of the marketing here about Russian, Bulgarian, all these.
Yeah, well, you know, it's so much bullshit out there.
And now somebody's asking about the best compound exercises for Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.
Well, it's interesting because the best compound exercise for Jiu-Jitsu are the best compound exercises for American football, for basketball, for life. The push, pull, horizontal, push, pull, vertical, a hinge, a squat. There you go. You know, Drew's big six. If you want, you can throw the abs. Obviously, you want to work your arm, your forearms, your neck, your feet, your calves. And you really got me into that tibia dorsiflexion. That is a neglected area. And in jiu-jitsu in particular, man, you want to work the front shin muscles because those muscles get a lot of work in jiu-jitsu. But it's not magic, you know? Just horizontal push-pull, vertical push-pull, hinge, squat, neck, forearms, grip, feet, calves. There you go. Not rocket science.
Okay. And somebody's asking now, how does it work? And I think he's asking about isometrics with movements that are hard to improve, like vertical leap. Trying a machine that mechanical load. Okay. Here's the thing. If you want to become better at performing a particular movement, like a leap, you got to practice the skills of leaping, and then you have to strengthen the muscles involved. What you don't want to do is attempt to mimic the skill you're trying to improve by loading it, or by performing a barbell or machine or even a bodyweight exercise that superficially resembles it. Leaping, mainly you're looking at the strength of the hip and thigh and calf muscles. And there's also, depending on the type of jump, some involvement of the shoulder and the rest of the body. Get as strong as possible, and you don't need any fancy equipment to do that. Well-designed machines, barbells and dumbbells, properly used, statics or isometrics, or even body weight. Just get as strong as possible, and then learn the best mechanics for the particular skill, in this case, jumping, and practice it. But you don't need specific exercises for specific sport or vocational skills or activities of daily living. The best exercises are the ones that are designed to efficiently load all the major muscle groups in accordance with muscle and joint function, not the ones that mimic these other movements, because you're going to end up with something that isn't as effective for exercise, isn't as safe, and isn't going to produce any specific skill that transfers over to that other activity. If you want to improve the skill in the activity, you have to practice that exact activity. Again, not mimic it with extra weight.
There's one thing I'd like to add too, because box jumps are so popular right now.
Nuts.
But just realize that a box jump is a specific skill. A box jump will not make you better at laying up a basketball. A box jump will not make you better at spiking a volleyball. A box jump will not improve your ability to do a standing broad jump. It's a skill. It's all based on this idea that you can selectively recruit fast twitch muscle fibers, which we know is simply not true. There's not one study that would support that. So, you know, these type of leaping drills are just a good way to just screw up your feet and your ankles and your knees, unless you need to do it for your sport. But even then, just be aware of the risk to benefit ratios. You know, no one ever said that these sports are particularly healthy.
And that's the interesting thing too, is if you're going to participate in martial arts in particular, or any kind of contact sport, or even a sport that's not a contact sport, but where there is a lot of contact anyways, participation involves accepting a certain amount of risk. Exercise, though, doesn't require it. There are, if you exercise, basically the way that we exercise, the way that we teach people and recommend, then you'll get the same general health and fitness and strength and all those benefits that you would doing a lot of other stuff, but with almost no risk of injury at all. There's no, you have to accept that there's going to be a certain level of risk, a higher level of risk with other activities, again, sports, you know, martial arts, things like that. With exercise, it's stupid to me that people are doing CrossFit and so a lot, some of these other programs, and just assuming that hard training means you're going to get hurt at some point, when it absolutely is not the case. You should almost never get hurt in the gym.
Even worse when they brag about the injuries, it's a badge of courage. Believe me.
It's stupid. It's utterly stupid. Again.
And you 20, 30-year-olds, by the way, a lot of these injuries will plague you for the rest of your life. And an injury that you get in your 20s or 30s will continue to erode and get worse.
Yeah.
It's not like you just heal and that's it. No. You may feel that every day for the rest of your life, every day you get out of bed. Yeah. So you got to take that into account too.
The only reason, literally, the only reason to do CrossFit, the only two reasons. One is if you plan on competing in CrossFit, in which case you have to practice the types of activities. I won't even call them exercises because most of them are awful choices for exercise, but also because you've got a bunch of hot young women, but you can find them elsewhere without beating yourself up.
Go to your local yoga classes.
Go to yoga. That would actually be a better idea. But if you are only concerned with becoming as strong and as fit as possible, and if you want to do it without wrecking your joints, without compromising your long-term health, don't do CrossFit. You can get the exact same benefit. You can get just as strong. You can get just as conditioned, properly performing conventional barbell or body weight or machine exercises, and it's still going to provide the same general benefits in terms of your overall functional ability. Even, you know, if you want to combine that with specific sports skill to be able to better perform, you know, football, basketball, or whatever, that's a better approach than trying to do CrossFit, which claims to improve all these other things like agility and balance and whatnot, which, I mean, we don't want to get into a big long thing about the different factors of functional ability and how they combine and what is specific and what isn't. But a lot of the claims that they're making, basically they're based on ignorance of or misunderstanding of motor learning principles.
Interesting how box jumps or jumping immediately brought up CrossFit.
Yeah,
because that's like one of the big moves in the CrossFit gym. Time I think of CrossFit, I think about the guy I saw completely skin his front shin.
That's
painful. I just cringe to think about.
If you want to get better at jumping, use proper exercises to strengthen the hip and thigh muscles, and then practice the specific types of jumping that you need to do for your sport or whatever the activity is that you want to improve at. And let's see here. Can isometrics completely replace dynamic exercise for hypertrophy? I know what I would say, but I'm going to leave it to you guys. I think we're probably on the same page on this.
I say absolutely. Once again, most people don't have the genetic potential for big G whiz muscles. I'm 67. I've tried all my life to get big G whiz muscles. Everyone in my family is little, wiry, kind of skinny little guys. My father, my grandfather. So I never had long muscle bellies, but there was a time in my life where I was pretty hypertrophied, and I found that the isometrics were able to maintain and even build on that. So yeah, when I was a young wrestler doing isometrics in the power rack and with the old York, I made really significant progress. I used to, you know, flex in the mirror after my isometric workouts, and I could see distinct increase in hypertrophy, even though that wasn't even my prime concern, even though I didn't have the genetic propensity for hypertrophy, I still saw significant difference. And with clients that I've been working with the time static contraction, I measure them, by the way. I take girth measurements. There has been a distinct increases. Never satisfactory. No one's ever satisfied, but noteworthy results in every client that I've worked with isometrics so far.
Now, speaking of isometrics, and this is also directly relevant to grappling, is you showed me a picture of somebody that you'd worked with that had been doing time static contraction crush gripping that was doing a hub grip holding up a 45 pound
the old
plate.
School, yeah. Yeah. Scott Burr. Scott was my first black belt. He lives in Chagrin Falls, Ohio. He just set up his own new gym just recently. Scott's been was training with me for many, many years in both Jiu Jitsu and in my fitness training. And he practices squeezing the crush grip style that Drew shows in his book, the time static contraction book. And we were messing around just hanging by one hand. And I thought I was pretty damn strong. And I made, like, I think it was like 27 seconds.
That's
and I was like, wow, you know, that was a record for me. And I was very proud of that. Scott jumps up and hangs, and he makes it for a minute and 45. It was unbelievable. And I said, what the hell are you doing? How are your hands so ridiculously strong? He said, I just squeeze. I just do a crush grip, like once, maybe twice a week at most. So he made a believer in me. So I like to use water bottles, by the way. There's plastic water bottles. They're perfect. You can really dig in there. You put your little finger around the top end, and you just crush for time. It's my favorite way. I love the feeling. It gives just a little bit.
That's one of the things that I like using the parts of the power rack for it, but it is the forearm fat grips.
Fat grips.
Those things are actually great for the crush.
I should get a pair of those. Even just crushing something like this, you know, like your forearm forklift and just fold it up.
It seems like a simple thing.
And just sit there and crush. Anyway, Scott claimed he got his deadly digits. The other thing too, we had a 55 pound anvil. Now I don't really ever try to lift an anvil before, but he actually uses it in his work. He's an artisan and a writer as well as a jiu-jitsu guy. Anyway, we were screwing around and he grabbed it by the horn and was able to clean it and press it. And if you've never tried that before, George Jowett demonstrates that. It's a demonstration of strength. I'm not advocating that you do this stuff. I'm just saying that if you just like screwing around like guys like to screw around, we were messing with his anvil. Anyway, I could lift it. There was no way I could clean it. But Scott could lift and clean. And he claims that he has built his deadly digits from crush grip times static contraction and hanging. There's two exercises. Yeah. And I've never felt stronger hands. Never.
And those are actually the three things that, and recently, now I wrote the Project Kratos, the body weight to high intensity training program back in 2013, right about a little bit after I started working on the UXS, I started working on that. And then I did a book on the time static contraction training, and I had done some grip work, but I was not doing as much as I probably, not nearly as much as I do now, but those are the three exercises, coincidentally, that I have in the workouts now. The crush grip, pinch grip, and then a support hang. And actually, that's why I've got the power rack set up the way I do. I'll post pictures later if people want to see, but I got a bunch of stuff from Rose specifically.
Killer, man.
Yeah, but people don't realize how much, and just now, I don't have hands like Scott, but just from doing this stuff, I don't know if you can see, we got a Rogue deadlift platform and had to go and get plywood for that. And my first thought was I'm going to get two sheets of plywood. I'm going to cut one of them down to 4 feet and then put just 2 feet of rubber on either side. But I decided, you know what, I'm just going to put rubber over the entire top. But I got the two sheets of plywood and I was able to just take those and just walk them up to the counter, just holding them. And there's no way that I probably could have done that without having done all this stuff with the grip work. So now here's the thing, that you know, and actually my youngest brother and I were joking about this, with the plywood is he, you know, because if you've ever carried sheets of plywood, you know, it's a bitch. Because first off, because of the 4 foot, you got to keep them out at arm's length, but also to be able to grip them. He said that eventually it's going to be like a strongman event carrying plywood, but then you're going to have a bunch of contractors who do this day in and day out, who are skilled at it, that are going to come and beat all these strongmen in this plywood carry. And of course, Rogue Fitness is going to have custom branded plywood sheets for you to practice with.
There's a lot of guys that laborers that like garage mechanics with the wrenches. Wow, are their hands and arms?
Well, they're using it regular. So again, but what are they doing to be able to maintain that grip? They are holding it isometrically. But yeah, just that static, and a minute or two at the end of your workouts, just the static crush gripping, you know, something that's a little bit larger diameter, and then pinch gripping, which is more of this puppet. A little bit different, because with this, it's more of lumbricals, whereas with this, it's more of the flexors.
And from a very practical point of view, too, I was training my aged mother-in-law. She's 83, and pretty youthful thinking, but she, you know, she's a very tiny little woman. She was complaining that she couldn't open jars, and she has this one coffee maker where she makes this delicious coffee every morning. She couldn't unscrew the coffee maker. Oh. So after just about 4 weeks of training her with time static contractions and doing a crush grip at the end, she says, Steve, I can open up the coffee and I can take the lids off these jars. So just from a practical point of view, if you have elderly relatives or whatever, and maybe they're a little stiff, time static contraction is perfect for these people. And keeping your hands strong well into advanced age is very, very important. In fact, there's a correlation between longevity and your hand strength.
Well, and something that, you know, and it drives me, I shouldn't say drives me, it's frustrating to me. Most people go into the gym and they're doing, they're working their chest, their back, their biceps, they're working their thighs. Most people are thinking about the mirror muscles, but the hands, and not just the hands, your neck, your forearms, your lower legs, but the hands, I very rarely see anybody doing, and there is a small like niche. There's a group of people who are obsessive about grip training. And John Wood,
functional hand training.
Look up John Wood. Great stuff on grip. But, and he's actually one that got me thinking, I need to get my stuff up to gear with the grip stuff. It doesn't matter how strong your arms are, how strong your shoulders, your back, your hips, your thighs. If you don't have the strength to grab something and hold on to it, you can't pick it up. You can't carry it. You can't pull it. Your hand strength is a limiting factor in your ability to use the rest of your strength in so many activities. And do you remember the bionic man and then later the bionic woman? And they had like a bionic leg. Lead majors. And then I can't remember the woman's name, blonde.
They're pretty.
I'll have to look it up later. But, you know, they had the one bionic leg and one bionic arm and the eye and the spine. But, you know, if you have one bionic leg, actually, no, the spine wasn't. And you're trying to pick up a car. Doesn't matter if you've got a bionic leg and a bionic arm. It's got to go through your spine.
Still got to go through your spine. Yeah,
and your hands, everything's got to go through your hands. So imagine trying to deadlift. No matter how strong you are, imagine if you had your grandmother's hands, but everything else was you. Wouldn't matter how strong the rest of you were. You're not gonna get the bar to budge. But people don't pay attention. And here's the thing, too. Most people think, well, if I'm deadlifting, if I'm doing all these pulling exercises, I'm already working my grip. You are, but here's the thing. The degree to which your body is stimulated to get stronger by an exercise depends on how hard the muscles are worked. Ideally, you want to get your muscles to a point of momentary muscle failure or pretty close to it. If your grip is not failing on these exercises, you're not working it as hard as you can and should be. But here's the thing. You don't want your grip to fail on the deadlift because the grip is not the goal of the deadlift. It's the hip and thigh and back muscles. You don't want your grip failing on a row or a chin-up or a pull-down. So if it is, you need to do something some sort of an aid until you can do it without it. But you should not be relying on those for the grip. Do a gripping or support grip hang or static crush gripping, static pinch gripping at the end of the workouts. Again, it only adds a little bit of time, and you will find that it will be so much easier to do literally anything that requires you to hold onto or pick something up. And it will, with grappling, though, because again,
grip is really important in grappling. But here's the problem. In grappling and other martial arts too, you're constantly making a fist. You're constantly gripping and grabbing. You get a lot of overuse in jiu-jitsu. Some jiu-jitsu guys have got to be very careful about adding extra grip. You usually end up with this epicondylitis from over gripping. Some guys' fingers and wrists and elbows get so sore that they can't even go to the class. What I've discovered was doing the reverse of gripping, finger and wrist extension, even just with your body weight, you know, using time static contraction, but also
that's also covered just, in the TSC.
Yeah, it's covered in Drew's material, but even just putting your finger in, I use a sock, or I live in Port Townsend, which is cold, so I wear gloves. So I'll pull the glove down and put my finger in the wrist part, and then I'll do a time static contraction. Finger and wrist extension in the glove, that makes a huge difference in preventing overuse and muscle imbalance. So don't forget, you got gripping, but you also have extending. So in order to prevent those overuse injuries, you got to open up those fingers and extend. And
if you
try, it can save a lot of elbow issues.
And if you try this, take your wrist and bend it back as far as you can go. And now, imagine you're trying to pull your knuckles to your elbow. Now, while holding that, try to extend your fingers while keeping that back. You'll find it gets harder and harder the fuller out. So if you start, again, imagine you're pulling your knuckles to your elbows. Now, keep that tight. And while you're keeping that tight, slowly try to straighten your fingers. This is harder than most people would think. And then if you hold that and keep trying to pull back, now like you're trying to touch your fingers to your elbow, you'll feel it all the way through here. Again, it's one of those things where you see us doing it on video and you're like, well, how can that possibly
be anything?
But try it and tell me what this feels like afterwards. And again, that's also in the
it's the same thing with the calf raise and the tibial dorsiflexion for your shins. You know, a lot of guys, you know, we're always flexing the calves, and the front shin muscles are largely neglected, all the top of the feet, the front of the ankles, the front of the shins, and in jiu-jitsu in particular, especially for the guard, arm locks, triangles, omoplata, where your feet are crossed and dorsiflexed, those muscles can fatigue very, very quickly.
It burns when they do too. It's uncomfortable.
But for elders, once again, I noticed that when I start working tibia dorsiflexion with a lot of people along with the cat, their gait improves, their ability to walk and move their feet, because a lot of people, their foot's dead. And, you know, they have, well, you know,
nerve damage.
You talked about balance issues and things. A lot of it's just sheer weakness, really. They're just so weak, the muscles can't take the stress of their own body weight, getting up and down from like a higher elevation to a lower elevation or stepping up. So by strengthening these feet and ankles and calves, wow, you can improve every.
I regret not doing this a lot sooner with people, because it used to only do dorsiflexion with people that had neurological problems, either, you know, hemiplegia or hemiparesis from stroke, or again, some people with diabetes, if the nerve damage starts getting bad, they get foot drop. But it really is beneficial. And here's the, you know, especially a lot of HIT guys now, well, you remember Mensa are really pushing those consolidation routines and really super ultra brief. And it's great for time convenience, but most people are not going to overtrain if they add a couple exercises for neck and forearms and grip and calves and the tibialis to their workout. The volume of something else to consider. Again, so many people have this idea that exercise volume is about sets and reps, but it's not. It's about the effort over the time. And the effort, not just the absolute effort of the muscles involved, but also the total amount of effort. Obviously, if you do a deadlift, it places more of a demand on your body than doing something like, you know, finger curl. Huge difference there. Kind of a ridiculous example, but it gets the point across. If you do a deadlift and a squat and a chin-up and a press and a dip and a row, and then you add a bunch more compound exercises, then yeah, maybe you'll overtrain. But if you're doing all that and then you add in, you know, some wrist and, again, wrist, neck, lower leg, you're not going to overtrain. And it only takes a few more minutes at the end of the workout. Let's see what other questions we got here. So we got a lot of people jumping in. So, top time static contraction exercise for forearm hypertrophy.
Those wrist extensions, yeah, that you show, or I like the forearm forklift where you do the little cow twist. The one forearm is in extension, yeah, the other one's in flexion. So
you're gripping. I'll go one way. To do this.
This is a little narrow, but I'll go one way and then go the other way. Wow.
Yeah, and you will have a towel too if you're at a hotel.
For something. Whatever genetic propensity you have for large Popeye type forms.
It's surprising. Basically, here's the thing. Your wrists can do a bunch of different things, but there's a lot of overlap in the muscles involved. If you're flexing and extending your wrists, you're pretty much involving all the stuff that you also have in adduction and abduction and, you know,
I mean, you don't have to do everything. I mean, no. you don't have to. I mean, I see some guys extension with like little pipes doing this type of. I mean, if you're a stick fighter, obviously you're going to have to do that. If you're handling weapons, that might be a good one to add in. But for the most part, this and this,
yeah,
that's it.
Oh, and Lindsay Wagner, thank you. Yeah, Lindsay Wagner, the bionic woman,
gorgeous gal.
Okay, and let's see. What are your thoughts on brisk walking as part of a strength and conditioning program?
I like to walk, but, you know, because you can't do a high intensity workout and then just sit in your ass for the rest of the day. You need to be active. You know, I don't do it for cardio, but I do it for circulation, obviously sitting for a prolonged, yeah. You get pulling, you know, you want to get the lymph flowing. So there's a lot of benefits to walking. I like to do breathing exercises that I learned in Sistema. And I use it as a meditation, really, like a walking meditation. I find that if I'm having a problem or whatever, and I go out and take a nice brisk walk, a lot of times the ideas will come to me. I can really think good in my feet. I do phone consultations sometimes. I love to put my earphones on, and I love to walk while I'm doing it because I can think a lot better when I'm on my feet. thinking on your feet. So yeah, for sure. If you like walking, go out and walk. There's, you know, it's a good health practice. Is it going to make you stronger or improve your physical conditioning? No. If you're a hiker and you like to backpack or whatever, or if you're in the military and you got to hump a big rucksack, well, then you got to practice that as a specific form of walking. Do I think weighted walking is good for you? No. I wouldn't load a rucksack and go out for a ruck march unless I was in the military and I had to do it, you know? I have a go bag, you know, in case the shit hits the fan. I do have my go bag. I do practice now and again, you know. I have all my little survival gear and my little go bag. But
do a whole show just on that.
Weighted walking, it's unnecessary. Regular walking is great. Even a little jogging out again. Do I do it for cardio? No. Do I do it for health? No. I do it for my mind, and I just enjoy the movement. Right. I tend to sit a lot on my iPad, so I got to get my lazy ass up and get out there and just move around a little bit. Am I doing it for fat loss? Not really. One part of my meal is going to erase any calories I burn. But it is, we are made to move. The human body is made to move. So move as much as you can.
Yeah, it's the same here. Right now I'm doing video like this, and I'm writing. I'm trying, I got a couple books I'm trying to get ready for. Actually, I don't know. I'm probably not going to hit January, but one for January, hopefully one for May, the next Kratos, next Bodyweight book. I'm sitting on my ass most of the day. It drives me absolutely nuts. I used to be on my feet from 6 o'clock until 6 or 7 o'clock.
When you were training. Yeah. When I was in the gym.
So I can't sit still, but I only work out about once every 3 to 4 days. And I actually find I do better if I work out every fourth day, but it's just kind of mental. Like it's easy. I like to have a Wednesday, Saturday schedule though. So, but every day I spend at least about an hour reading. And I make sure I get up and I walk when I do, because it's otherwise I hate sitting all the time. And again, really, here's the thing though. This is important. There are benefits. There are physical and mental benefits to regular physical activity. Or look at it another way. There's a bunch of downsides to being sedentary. You need to be moving around. There are benefits to just moving around. Benefits to your joints, circulation, your brain. Again, not just circulation of blood, but also circulation of lymph. You can't sit on your ass all day long. But it's important to understand that exercise and activity are not the same.
Not the same.
No amount of general physical activity is going to replace exercise. And by exercise, I'm specifically talking about placing a significant demand on your muscles. Strength training really is the only thing that technically should be considered exercise. Everything else is just physical activity, or at the most, a conditioning activity, but not technically exercise.
One thing I do want to mention, I spend time in Ikaria every year, which is renowned for the oldest people on earth. It's one of the blue zones. I also just read this article on Azerbaijan up in the mountains, these people living like well over 100. But I'll tell you something, I wouldn't want to look like any of them. I'd rather be fucking dead, man. Seriously. It's not enough just to live a long life. So you can probably live a long life if you have good genes, good genetics, without strength training. But I'll tell you, the in Ikaria, these old people, that most of them were obese. Most of them were barely ambulatory. Many of them leaning heavily on a cane. It's not my ideal. I'd rather live to 80 rather than 100 and be able to have full function right up to the day I die. I mean, that's just the way I think. Maybe I'll change my tune when I get a little closer to 80.
Okay, we got another question about, are there different time static contraction protocols for strength versus hypertrophy?
No.
Not really. Here's the thing.
Momentary muscular failure.
Yeah. Hypertrophy usually follows strength. And this is why. Strength is not just changes in the actual muscle fiber. So most of us, we think of strength, think of increases in myofibrils. We think of more nuclei, or actually more satellite cells moving into the muscle fibers, becoming more nuclei, et cetera, et cetera. And we think about that, and then we think of hypertrophy as being more sarcoplasmic. There is really not much evidence that you can selectively train for one versus the other. if you want to get bigger, you've got to become stronger. Now, here's the thing, though. Strength gains are also, it's not just the tissue. There's also neurological adaptations. And your body does not want more muscle than it needs, because muscle mass is expensive tissue to create. It is expensive tissue to maintain. The more muscular you are, the higher your metabolic rate, which we think that's a great thing because we live in a time where calories are plentiful and cheap. But from a survival standpoint, more muscle, that's more tissue to feed. It's a liability. It's a cost. So your body is not going to produce more muscle tissue unless you give it a damn good reason to, unless you push yourself so hard in your workouts that you send the message to the body that, hey, we need to be stronger to be able to deal with whatever is happening in the environment that's stressing us this badly. Your body's going to try to be as efficient as possible, though, and it's going to try to produce as much of a strength gain through neural adaptations as it can before it starts increasing the actual tissue. So sometimes you will see a strength gain before you will see a size gain. But, and here's the thing, and I think this is where this comes from. The ratio of strength to size is going to be pretty similar for any individual. For a certain amount of strength increase, eventually you're going to have a certain size increase. But it is different between different individuals. Some people will barely gain any size despite getting really strong. Every one of you probably knows some guy who's ridiculously strong relative to his size. And there's other factors involved. But there's also some people who look very muscular, but they're not nearly as strong as you would expect them to be based on how much muscle mass they have. Well, here's the thing. If somebody genetically is predisposed to having a lot of strength relative to their size, they're going to gravitate towards activities where a strength to size ratio is an advantage, anything with a weight class. But
gymnastics.
Or you're going to have, but if you have people that tend to gain a lot of size, but not as much strength, you're going to see more of them going into bodybuilding. Now, when you get at people that are drawn to these activities, typically the people will continue to train with the activity in the mind. And they will say, well, I'm training to get stronger, but I don't want too much size. Or the bodybuilders, I just want as much size as possible. I don't care how strong I am. The assumption is that there's different training for hypertrophy than there is for strength. But what is really happening is people who are better in one or the other tend to select for the activities that they are better at, and they assume that that's what they're doing. Now, it's not... There may be some things that influence a little bit one way or a little bit the other, but beyond some point, if you want to get bigger, you just have to keep focusing on getting stronger, because you're certainly not going to get bigger if you don't need the extra tissue for the strength. You want to get as big as possible, just focus on training to get as strong as you possibly can and getting enough quality protein.
It's kind of like each workout should tap into the survival mechanism, basically, you know, biology 101.
Oh, and somebody's asking what your well, I think we kind of probably covered it, but what is your opinion of Marcelo Garcia's opinion that additional strength and conditioning training is unnecessary?
I've heard this before. Once again, he's a motor genius. There's one Marcelo Garcia and everybody else, you know, he's a phenom. Would he be even better if he did strength and conditioning? I believe he would. I don't think there's anyone on the planet, no matter how good or how bad, that wouldn't be better if they could become stronger. I had this conversation with Hickson not too long ago. Hickson did strength training. He believed in it very, very much. He felt that he was an even better athlete when he was stronger. Think of it this way. In martial arts, we're told that you shouldn't use more than 60% of your strength, that the rest of it should be skill. But we've all felt guys that just seem massively strong and maybe even accuse them of using strength. But the fact of the matter is, maybe the guy isn't using strength. A lot of times the guy will say, oh, no, I'm not using any power at all. And he's right. Because if you're supposed to use 60%, of your strength, but let's imagine now that you increase your strength dramatically, well, then 60% of your strength would be more than 100% of most people. So yeah, if you're really, really strong and you're still using just a small portion of that strength, it's going to still be overwhelming. There's not a sport or activity where being stronger doesn't improve your performance.
Here's one. What problems do experienced trainees encounter when switching to time static contraction?
Mostly mental. A lot of it is your pain threshold. You got to be able to build up your concentration, and you got to be able to build up your tolerance to, I don't want to say pain, exercise discomfort.
Yeah,
it's very high in the beginning. It's shocking. It's like anything else.
Try the hip belt squats that we demonstrated earlier. If you do it, you follow the directions that we gave, you'll get kind of an idea of what you're talking about. It's like. It is.
Well, after reading your article in your blog,
the one where I did the original
hip belt, and I tried it. I didn't make it. I felt like, oh my God.
It was.
But after just a couple times, my tolerance to the first, I knew what to expect. The first time, you don't know what to expect. But, you know, after trying a couple, then I was able to make it through. Of course, obviously, I built my strength.
I got a lot of hate mail after that blog from people with just tortured thighs.
But you do build a tolerance to it. But, that's your number one block. It's the mental. And that's the thing I like about it, because it is so mental. You know, most of bodybuilding strength, it's all extrinsic. You know, amount of weight, amount of reps, looking in the mirror, all my pecs, my huge arms. You know, it's all extrinsic factors. With time static contraction, it's very intrinsic. It's all internal. It's like a zen of strength training. It's very meditative. This is why it's so good for martial arts. You know, it really develops a focus, a hyper laser-like focus.
And I think it also helps sometimes teaching people time static contraction first. If you are going to have them do dynamic exercises later on, they are better able to maintain strict form and work through that severe muscle burning and discomfort if they've already got that down from the TSC. Because that is one of the, I don't want to really call it a downside, but I mean, if you do it correctly.
Pretty uncomfortable.
It's,
but you learn to breathe through it, you know?
It's safe. It's so much safer than other. I would use it as a primary protocol for a lot of people, especially anybody who's got any injuries, and especially for exercises that you might be, like the neck. I've always been very, very, neck exercises are important. Everybody should train their neck. There's no reason that anybody should not work their neck, but I've always been really cautious about recommending it, because if people do a neck exercise, if I'm there instructing them, it's one thing. But if I tell you to do a neck exercise and you're in some gym across the country and I don't know what you're doing and I can't correct you, I don't want you to fuck your neck up, because that's on me for telling you to do the neck exercises. But with the time static contraction, if you follow the directions, you can work your neck as intensely as you can stand it, and you're not going to hurt yourself.
It's like medicine. I've had neck injuries and I do the time static contraction. Wow, my neck feels fantastic
were in an accident. Actually, I've been in a couple of car accidents. None of them. I've been one with a drunk driver that came right in front of us in the highway. I actually hit my head on the windshield before. I wasn't wearing my seatbelt. It's a long story. But I hit my head before the airbag then threw me back into the seat. The car was almost total. It was bad. We had another one where I was a passenger. I was in the back seat of a SUV that was T-boned, because the driver wasn't paying attention, made a left turn through a red light, and my neck did one of these. And we've been in fact, we were here for the 1995 Super Slow Exercise Guild Convention, and a couple of us went to Club One of the strip club later in the evening, and the very next afternoon, we were actually rear-ended by one of the girls that had danced at our table the night before. So that was kind of an awkward...
A good friend of mine, his name is Hedges Labre. He was my partner in Philly. I brought him up from Rio, got him his green card. I actually sold my Jiu Jitsu school to him when I got divorced and moved out of Philadelphia. Hedges was rear-ended on the New Jersey Turnpike. Now, this is a strong Brazilian guy who's won multiple world titles, one of the best Jiu Jitsu guys. He was Sully Barra's first black belt. Guy's amazing. He runs Gracie San Diego. I recommend any of you guys look him up. One of the best coaches I ever had. Anyway, the car hit him so hard that it actually literally jumped out of the trunk into his back seat and totaled his car. He had horrible whiplash. He hadn't been working his neck at that point, and he was forced to do it for rehabilitation. And the time set of contractions totally got him out of pain. And he got to the point where he's – but, I mean, he suffered really badly with terrible headaches and upper neck and back for a long time. So had he been working his neck, I can't say that he wouldn't have been injured. There's no way you can make that assumption. But it probably would have been less. But he got out of the pain through neck work.
Now, I have no neck pain, none. As long as – and I know the timing. If I do the time set of contraction, flexion, and extension once every – at just one, now, I do it weekly, but if I do it at least once every 3 weeks, I'm good. If I start going longer for that, then I start getting it like through this side where I start not being able to turn as far. But as long as I'm doing it, nothing. I've had clients who have been in car accidents who have come to me after months of conventional physical therapy, which did not help them at all, and had them perform. This was way back. We used to do the manually resisted super slow, four super slow reps, moderate, hard, almost as hard as they can, then as hard as they can, which is very similar to the time static contraction protocol. Later, same thing, but with time static contraction. And within weeks, they said, holy shit, my neck doesn't hurt anymore. I can move my head. I wasted months and months in physical therapy. I should have just done this. And
same with me. I've had multiple neck injuries in my wrestling and jiu-jitsu career. And I've had ongoing neck pain here and there. Of course, I was a nomadic traveler for the last 15 years. So sleeping in a different bed with different pillows kind of screws you up too. But I'm telling you, the simple isometrics for the forearm forklift, simple. It's not complex. Just extension, flexion, occasionally lateral. But my neck is pain-free. And believe me, years and years of stress on the body from these tough boy sports.
And you know, if you want to pick these up, these things, they're like $15 to $20. You can get them at Home Depot. You can get them at Amazon.com.
Amazon delivered tomorrow.
Yeah. And again, I wrote a book on it, so a little biased here. But if you go to the there should be a link somewhere down below. But the Time Static Contraction Training ebook, and then the 2019 update, and they're together in the High Intensity Training ebook bundle. It covers a ton of stuff that you can do, isometric exercises and just this, including that belt squat that Steve demonstrated earlier, which again, that version of it that can be performed with a strap was, he was the one that figured out how to do that. Again, with the gi belt.
It's just frustration. I wanted to do what Drew was doing with his, but traveling, I'm not going to pack a little board. So I said, how can I do this? And I said, oh, wait a second.
It works. Let's see if we got any more questions here. Yeah, leverage is a huge. Let's see. Any studies showing significant muscular growth using time static contraction exclusively? Nobody's really doing studies specifically on time static contraction, but just we've seen studies on isometric, and it's the same principle. It's just a more strict application of it. We know that if you do isometrics intensely enough, you're going to have similar strength and size increases. And subjectively, having worked, well, not completely subjectively, I should say anecdotally, having worked with a lot of clients doing this, I haven't seen any significant difference. It's safer. If you do it hard enough, you're going to get the same strength and size increases. Personally, and again, I'm not Joel Waldman. I don't know if any of you know who Joel Waldman is, but when he was younger, his neck was like 21, 21
probably
and a
half still
inches.
Is.
He has a neck like a bull.
Like your thigh.
My neck is not as big as Joel's, but I have a decent sized neck. I don't even know what the measurement is right now, but I used to use Ken Hutchins Super Slow Systems four-way neck machine. And I haven't used a four-way neck machine for years. I've been using only time static contraction for the neck exercises. And I have not, I've actually getting my shit together and cleaning up my diet and jumping my protein up, I probably put on a little bit of size, but I have done it without resorting to any dynamic exercise for the neck. Same thing for the forearms. Almost all my forearm and grip stuff is time static contraction. So yeah, it's
well, one of the original pioneers in isometrics was Alexander Zass, and he was a circus strongman, and he built his strength, which was prodigious. Just look up Zass. He actually, there's a book in Amazon about his life, and he saw the circus strongman bending iron bars, but he was just a poor farm kid, so he would go into the forest. And he would work on bending saplings. He'd start with little ones and keep building up. And he got to the point where he could break chains. But he worked using time static contraction using chains. And look at the physique of the guy. The unbelievable development.
Was it?
And this is at an era where
there was no drugs.
There was no drugs. There was no, there wasn't even a Flintstone vitamin, man. These guys were just basically eating food and drinking a lot of beer. And this guy was an incredibly strong man. And you can read about him. So there is plenty of anecdotal evidence to support isometrics. The other guy, Maxik, who used to do the Charles Atlas.
Oh, yeah, the dynamic tension,
where you're actually just creating isometric tension from flexing your muscles. Check out Maxik's physique. He claimed it was the isometrics that built his tremendous physique. There was a lot of the old time guys that would use isometrics as part
Earl
of
the Lederman and some of the
Earl Lederman was a big one. Even Eugene Sandow would do a lot of isometrics. Check out Bruce Lee. He was a skinny guy with zero potential for muscular size, but what he did with a chiseled, ripped physique, check out John Little's book.
I think I've got some, I need to organize
The Dragon's Body is called. Anyway.
Yeah, all my, where is this? Oh crap. I've got a bunch of John Little's books back up here.
Tons and tons. Henry Wittenberg, early isometric pioneer, won Olympic gold medal and Olympic silver medal in the Helsinki Olympics. And then later in the London Olympics, was a huge isometrics proponent. And had a fantastic muscular physique. So just you know, without the studies. But, you know, try it yourself for a month. You're not going to lose anything. Bob Hoffman
had good results with it. He was training the U.S. Olympic team with it.
He was training his Olympic weightlifters that's where the power rack came from. It was called an isometric power rack. And you would practice holding a barbell against pins for time. And these guys were getting really, really good results.
Let's see what else we have. Okay. Oh, here's the trick. Oh, okay. We're not going to talk about any of the motorized electronic equipment in this one, but
that's another video.
Yeah. That's a whole nother thing. We're not going to talk about that particular company. And here, let's see, best way to measure progress with timed static contraction. Now this is a little bit tricky because if you are performing timed static contraction, it is done against an immovable or unyielding object. If I take a door frame and I do an isometric or it's a time static contraction lateral raise against the door frame, I have no measurement of the increase in strength over time. If I do a belt squat, I have no measurement of the increase in strength over time. What I recommend if people don't have access to equipment that is what's called computer feedback statics, like Ken Hutchins' RenX machines, is to periodically check a dynamic version of the exercise, a body weight squat, a chin up, a push up. If you're getting stronger on those movements using consistent form, then you know everything else that you're doing is right. But here's the thing, and what I can do is compare though. For a long time, in fact, I moved here in 1996. For most of the time from 96 until about 2013, other than just a few years, I was working as a trainer with Ken Hutchins. We had machines that were specifically designed for time static contraction that displayed in real time a person's force. And I saw people doing time static contractions get stronger, increase their force output on a weekly basis, constantly being able to hit a little bit higher targets than they were previously. So I have seen it done on the computer feedback equipment and seeing that it does produce regular strength increases. And what would happen is once in a while, if we were really busy And I would normally have somebody do a static row or a static chest press or the pullover, pull down, any of these things or whatever exercise. And Ken had a client on it and he was just starting and I wanted to keep things going. I would have somebody do the dynamic version instead. And I would typically just have them use the same weight that they did the very last time they used the dynamic version, or I would guess based on their time static contraction, the computer feedback static force. And whenever they did it multiple times, even if it was a lot of static in between, they were always able to do more reps or basically we're keeping track of time under load, go for a little bit longer time or use a little bit heavier weight than previously. So you will get stronger doing it, but it doesn't provide immediate feedback. Now, there are some things that you can do, though.
Like force gauge?
Yeah, you can get a force gauge, or you can get some exercises you can do with a spring scale that you can put in line with the strap. But if you don't have that...
One guy was standing on a bathroom scale when he was doing it. And then subtracting his weight from the... But here's something, too, that I do sometimes. Of course, I'm 67. My best days are way behind me. Many multiple injuries. I probably hit my peak in my 20s, you know, because I started training when I was very young, 12 years old. So obviously I built my hill, but I noticed that I'm able to really maintain my hill quite well. I will use super slow chin-ups or pull-ups, push-ups or dips, bodyweight squats as a little test now and again, especially if I've been doing time static contraction for a really long time. And I found I'm able to maintain the same number of super slow reps I did when I was in my 40s, my 50s. So obviously there's no loss. There's not going to be a buildup. You know, once you've been training 3 to 5 years, you pretty much hit your genetic peak. Now your hill's built, just got to keep that hill going. So you don't end up with a steady loss of motor ability and decline. You know, you want that to be very gradual and then you die.
Hold on.
One day, you know, one day you just don't wake up.
All right. Let's see here. I'm going to talk about slow push-ups. It says, friend can push up 15 minutes without interruption at a slow pace, during which time he does 240 push-ups. Yeah, that's...
Well, there are some freaks of nature like that.
Either he has extremely low neurological efficiency, very high ratio of strength to body weight, or he's doing the push-ups in a way that are very, very easy. Because that's a long time.
That's a long time.
Yeah. Let's see.
But you do get some really crazy phenoms. I watched this Russian guy on YouTube do 100 pull-ups. Of course, he was taking a dead hang, 10-second rest between each one. But still, just to hang on a damn bar for 10 minutes. Holy
and
God.
I wanted to do an experiment. This was back when I only, right now I'm about 205, 206 pounds or so. But back when I was maybe about 180, I did an experiment just because I wanted to see, you know, how long you could stretch something out if you just kept increasing the rest a little bit. And so chin-ups. And I think I did maybe, I think it was 14 or 15. And then I couldn't do another one. So I waited 5 seconds, did another one, 5 seconds. And I kept doing that. When I couldn't do another one after 5 seconds, I would add a few more seconds. And I ended up getting to something like 140 somewhere in there over a half an hour by continuously increasing the rest. And but that was with resting in between. So if you rest, you can. But I was not, I would stop and I would set my feet down in between instead of hang. The most impressive thing about that to me is that he was able to maintain his grip.
Yeah, this Russian guy. Yeah.
That is.
He held on to the bar for 10 minutes without putting his feet down.
Yeah.
I kept looking closely to see if they just did a loop with a tape to see if there was any change in the guy's technique. But towards the end, you could see him struggling. So it was obvious that he was getting a little bit tired.
Yeah.
And someone told me that they actually know that guy and that they said it was legit. So I'm just taking their word for it.
So and
actually, but there are some people with just amazing genetics.
Yeah, that and coming back to what we were talking about earlier with the grip stuff.
10 minutes.
Yeah, that's unbelievable. And again, it seems like such a simple thing, just hang from a bar. But honestly, at the end of your workout, if that's all you do is you just hang onto a bar, just the support grip hang for as long as you can. And actually, I'm going to tell you something else. you can take this time static contraction. We were talking the other day about the leg assisted chin ups, leg assisted pull ups and dips technique.
I think
you
can do it with. It's advanced. It's not just beginner. That's an advanced exercise if you do it right.
If you do it right. And so, you know, if you want to know what I'm talking about with the leg assisted stuff, again, get the book. I'll put a link. But with the grip stuff, if you can't hang on, what you do is you set it so that you're hanging so that your feet can touch. And what you do is you gradually let off with your feet. So 30 seconds using just enough effort with your feet that it only feels moderately hard. And then you pick your feet up a little bit so then it feels almost as hard as you can. And then you use the minimal amount of assistance from your legs and feet necessary to be able to just hold on while squeezing as hard as possible. And you can do this with a regular size bar, a support hang. You can use it with a thick bar doing a crush grip hang or blocks doing pinch grip hang. And the goal is to eventually get to a point where you can just hang. And it actually, we were just talking about a scale. If you did this while standing on a spring scale, you would actually be able to see over time how little assistance you needed to be able to maintain that hang too. So again, it seems like a simple thing, but doing this would the effects on your grip are
it is
just,
pretty amazing.
Yeah.
I still have a pretty good grip. I still get on the mat and roll with these young guys, and everyone says, wow, what a grip. So
it's
stuff works, man.
And again, it is underrated. Most people, if you have stronger hands and it makes a huge difference to almost everything you do. And we are actually coming up on over 2 hours, I think almost 2.5 hours. Here.
Wow, man, so you can split this video in like three.
We're live, so this is all going. But yeah, we could probably split it up a little bit later.
Any more good questions?
Well, that's what I'm looking for. Because first off, thanks to everybody who came and watched today. And hopefully you got a lot out of the video. And actually, before we check the last questions, where can they get a hold of you for coaching? Where can they find you online if they're interested in the videos and other things?
My website is MaxwellSC.com, MaxwellSC.com. I'm going to be changing my website over soon. But on there is a list of my services and what I do. And I do online coaching. I have a lot of jiu-jitsu guys. But interestingly enough, I have a lot of elderly people too, a lot of people that have hurt themselves doing regular exercise. And right now I have a couple openings for some new clients. And then I sell videos on different things I've been interested in. Some of them I'm no longer into. You know, I still have some kettlebell stuff on there. No longer interested in that. Did that, realized a step in the wrong direction. But, you know, sometimes you have to experience these things to learn the truth. So I kind of veered from the high intensity path for, well, actually I was always doing HIIT, even with kettlebells. But sometimes you veer from the path and then you realize, well, kind of made a mistake there and you get back on. But my ex-wife was an early kettlebell pioneer. Her name's DC Maxwell. She's a third degree black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. The third woman to get a black belt in the United States in Jiu-Jitsu. And she used to say to me, you know, I feel damn near injured almost every kettlebell workout. And she mentioned to me, she was on the cover of Pavel's book From Rush with Tough Love. She said to me one time, she says, wouldn't it be a real kick in the pants if 10 years from now we find out this stuff is just doing us a lot of harm? And I said, hush your mouth. Shut up. Yeah, I didn't want to hear it. But she was right. She actually has had a hip replacement surgery. She had to have her hip done.
That sucks.
And she blames a lot of the kettlebell stuff. So just saying. I'm not saying it doesn't work. I'm just saying it's not the best way to do it.
Absolutely. If you do it hard, progressively and consistently, and if the volume and frequency doesn't exceed what your body can recover from and adapt to, you can get stronger and better conditioned using kettlebells.
But for me, time static contraction, super slow body weight training, the safest, and it keeps this old guy going, man.
Doing it this way, it'll get you just as strong as training with the kettlebells.
Transferable strength.
Kinder to your joints and back. Okay, what do we have?
Well, a lot of people tuned in. That's really cool.
See, does push up very well. Okay, yeah, we'll watch the video later. That's really rare, though. Although, here's the thing. People tell me he does this well, he does that well, I do this well, that I do. Most people have absolutely no idea of the standards to which I would, you know, hold people during exercise. Most people think I honestly, and I'm not going to call anybody out, but I've actually seen guys on Twitter and Instagram and Facebook post videos of the absolute most atrocious form while referring to themselves as form Nazis. And saying, you know, talking about how strict their form is, but and these are guys who are advising other and training other people. And it is absolutely, it's embarrassingly bad. It's embarrassingly bad. So I know people think that their form is good, but most people have no idea what really good form even looks like. Speaking of
which, I didn't see the question, but is he indicating that push-ups are sub-maximal?
Oh, no, he was about the guy that I mentioned earlier. He said that his friend is doing push-ups for 15 minutes straight.
Because here's the thing. In Drew's book, he mentions IAC, intentional agonistic co-contraction. You can purposely create even more tension than you need to lift your body weight. And you isometrically contract your muscles while doing dynamic movement. And if you use the Kratos scaling, partial range, working in the weak range, even the strongest Olympic caliber athlete is going to be brought to his knees with liquid running out of every orifice of his body.
And you're not just saying, I mean, you actually had put people through this strong, really well-conditioned athletes.
I had a guy who claims he could bench 450 that managed to get 6 push-ups.
It's so much harder when you do it.
I didn't let him walk out. I put a strap on him, so he couldn't walk out. So he was coming up against that strap. And if he came up too quick on the time, which he was, I made him hold until – and then – he just died like a rat.
It is so much. Same here. I've had guys who say, oh, well, I squat 300, I squat 400, whatever, for repetitions. And then when you force them to do the exercise with what is actually strict form, it ends up being so much harder. And here's the problem, too. There's some things, even if we were to demonstrate some of this stuff on video, there are things that are happening internally and things that are very subtle that you might not be seeing, like what you're doing with your hips versus your thighs as you're doing a bodyweight squat. The way, basically what you are focusing on contracting, internal intake or intentional antagonistic co-contraction is not something that can be demonstrated. It can be taught, it can be explained, but you can't see what's happening other than just the shaking that results at some point.
And if a person is really good at doing the exercise, he makes it look really easy. As a matter of fact, when you're doing super slow sometimes, like not just you, but anyone that's really skilled, it almost looks like they're not working out.
No, it doesn't.
And all of a sudden you think, well, why did he quit? Instead of the hysterics and like the twisting and what did Ken call that? Mammalian panic reflex or something?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like you get into a panic state because as you begin to fail, when you take all those hysterics out and you control your breathing and you're working internally, you know, it's just like someone cuts off the electricity. Poof, that's it. You just can't move it.
The only possible, well, you can see people start breathing a little bit heavier, but and the more fatigue you get, they start to slow down and shake a little bit. But otherwise, when you actually see somebody using good form, the first rep doesn't really look that much different than the last because they're continuing to maintain proper positioning, proper speed, proper turnarounds, all this stuff. Most of what people think of as hard work is literally, it's all the things that people do to avoid hard work, all of the offloading onto other muscle groups and trying to bounce and yank and
rising,
jerk the weight,
twisting, yawning, jerking, screaming,
the faces,
yelling.
All the stuff.
It's unloading.
Let me see if we got any other questions. Otherwise, we'll go grab some steak.
Yeah, man, I think you've taken care of like a week's worth of videos right here. Man.
Yeah, it looks like we got almost everybody. So once again, I want to thank everybody who's come and watched this. Especially if you've been with us for 2.5 hours, maybe you're watching it in chunks or something like that. But again, I'll put your link in there. And then later on when you change the website link, I can come back and update it. So you know where to get a hold of Steve if you're interested in coaching or videos, things like that. My information is down there below too.
I'm on Twitter too.
Yeah, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all that. So we'll put that information in there after we get some steak and come back and update it. Just trying to think if there's anything else. Well, yeah, actually the one thing, if you aren't already subscribed, subscribe. Make sure you hit the like button if you got something out of this video. And there's an alert bell. If you want to be notified when I am doing videos like this, hit that alert bell. But actually, better yet, I don't do that many of these videos publicly, but I do videos about 3 or 4 times a week in my private Facebook group for hit list members. And right now there's about like 350 something videos in there, over 250 hours on a broad range of topics. In fact, a lot of the questions that people ask here, we've gone over in a lot of detail there as well. So if you want even more information on this, there should be already a link down there that you can click to join that. So anything else you want?
Yeah, just one word of appreciation to Drew. First of all,
like, my pleasure having you. It's been awesome.
I mean, I've been in this game for a long time. Like I said, I started in 1964, and I've seen a lot of things. And, you know, I've met Arthur Jones. I've been at Arthur Jones' house. You know, I went through some of the MedX testing. I've known Al Darden for years, Doug McGuff, all these guys. This is one of the most knowledgeable guys. I'm always continually learning. That. One thing I like about Drew, he's not stuck in his ways. He's open-minded. He's willing to entertain anything. And the hit list site, I'm telling you, it's just a wealth of information. I pick up new stuff all the time. And not just from Drew, but other members, other knowledgeable members that have been in the game. So keep open-minded. You can never stop learning. And staying with communities like the hit list will give you incentive, because there's a lot of crazy stuff out there, a lot of naysayers, a lot of misinformation, disinformation. You need to stay focused. And when you're a member of a hit list community like this, it reinforces your workouts and keeps you on the straight and narrow path so that you don't get pulled off with a lot of nonsense. Just my.
All right. Awesome. Thank you again.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it.
Sure, everybody seems
to. It was fun, man.
All right, so let's see here. Guys are hoot. Just enjoying you guys having it. Okay. So, yeah, well, glad everybody liked it, and I guess that's it for now. I don't know if next time you're in Orlando.
Next time, man, let's get some steak, man.
All right, time for steak.
Let's get some meat.
We'll see you guys next time.
What's for dinner?